Good evening. Welcome to the Town of Deerfield Select Board Board of Health meeting. This is October 12th, 2021. The time is 6:01. Main meeting room, Deerfield Municipal Offices, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass. This meeting will be held in a hybrid fashion with the opportunity for both in-person attendance and remote participation in accordance with the Governor Baker's June 16th, 2021 Act extending certain COVID-19 measures adopted during the state of emergency, including an extension of remote participation provisions of his March 20th, 2020 executive order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law, Mass General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 20. Please note that while an option for remote attendance and participation is being provided as a courtesy to the public, the meeting hearing will not be suspended or terminated if technical problems interrupt the virtual broadcast unless otherwise required by law. Members of the public with particular interest in any specific item on this agenda should make plans for in-person versus virtual attendance accordingly. For purpose of in-person attendance, the Town of Deerfield will host the meeting in the main meeting room of the Deerfield Municipal Offices with remote participation details listed. Dial-in number is 929-205-6099. That meeting ID is 911-604-1580, and the passcode is 570012. For the Zoom meeting, you can go into the Town of Deerfield website and go on the agenda for the Board of Select Board, and I'll give you the connection to the Zoom. And I'll call the meeting to order.
Sure.
Okay. The first thing we have on our agenda is a continuation of the hearing, Eversource poll hearing. Continued from 10/12/21.
Welcome back.
Hi. Yeah, good to be back. Good evening, everyone. So we have a revised proposal for the installation of the underground facility. I did send out previously the new revised file. I'm not sure if we have it for the broadcast.
We have that, Jen. Do you know anything we can put up?
Do you mind just introducing yourself again?
Oh, sorry. I apologize. My name is Virgil Silva, and I'm with Eversource.
Thank you.
Actually, if you leave the mic there, you get better coverage because it's picking up what's coming into the console.
Yep.
Yeah, sure. Let me, it's in the, oh no, it's not in the packet.
Not in the packet. So you have a revised one?
Yes. File. Other week, I believe.
Hold on, I can get it, Gilbert. Is this Gilberto?
Yes.
You can keep talking while I find it.
Okay. Wait, what do you think?
Yeah, so essentially the plan was what we earlier discussed, so we'll be using the existing last pole, overhead pole on Set Right Road, use that as the new location to go underground for Old Frontier solar facility. And then the customers that are currently underground from that pole on Set Right Road will put them a pole back, essentially. That will mean that we'll have to dig first under a driveway. I don't recall the house number, but corner, and as well as across Set Right Road, so we can go to the east side of Set Right Road. But it's feasible, doable. It'll satisfy the need of not adding a new pole.
Okay.
It'll reliably feed both commercial and residential customers. I think it checks all boxes. The longer project, more expensive on our end, but it checks all the boxes, I believe.
Okay. And so if there's an outage or overload on at the solar field, it's not affecting the, that was the goal, right?
Exactly. So we everybody else separated, exactly.
Yep.
And that's the revised plan. I'm not sure.
You're moving back one. Yeah, you're moving back to that, to the north side of the road, right from that corner.
Can you increase the size a little bit, Jen?
Sure.
That's old folks.
One second.
Okay.
Right. So in total, will the 128 feet that goes from the new riser for the residential customers all the way to the east side of Set Right Road, where we'll then introduce a splice box. It's noted there. Same box that we'll have near the transformer. It's it'll be level with the ground. Same scenario. We'll have a couple of doors.
Yep.
And it's made of like a polymer concrete. 79 inches by 43 and 3 feet deep, so they can splice the cable in there.
Right.
Not sure if there are questions or.
I'm very appreciative that you revisited this and came up with this solution.
Oh no, not a problem. It's it's one of those things we weren't aware of that requirement. Because if I did, that would be probably the plan from the get go.
Yep.
But I'm great. Glad we all. Happy with it.
I'm good. Any comments from the residents on Set Right? This meets with your report.
No new polls. Okay.
Okay. Great.
I will make a motion to approve this.
So close the hearing.
Oh, okay. I'll close the hearing.
You have a hand up. Does that?
Annalee,
I'm sorry.
Thank you. So if I can just verify that what you are doing now is consistent with the original site plan review conditions and the considerations that were given to the abutters, that there are no new structures and poles.
No new poles.
Owner polls, correct.
Correct. Thank you.
All right. I make a motion to close the hearing then.
No other questions? I'll second that motion.
Any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Hi, Caroline.
Hi, Trevor McDaniel.
Hi, Dave. Welcome. Hearing is closed.
Make a motion to approve the plan as presented.
I'll second that motion.
Yeah. Any further discussion? And hearing is, all those in favor?
Hi, Carolyn.
Hi, Trevor McDaniel.
Hi, Dave Wolfman.
Thank you. Thank you. Really appreciate your help.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There.
Thank you for coming back.
Not a problem.
The next thing on our agenda is Lily.
Where is it good for us to be talking?
Right there. It works. That mic. You should pick up that mic right there.
Hi, I'm Lily Dwight, South Mill River Road Chair of the Ad Hoc Senior Housing Committee. Can everybody hear me?
No.
No?
Just speak up.
Hello.
There you go. That worked.
Bill Sergeant voice, Lily.
That worked.
Thank you.
All right. I can speak louder for the room as long as these guys.
Yeah, everyone online can hear it. Fine.
For some reason, using our Wi-Fi, I cannot get onto Zoom. I do not know what is going on. Deerfield guest.
Deerfield guest has been having some issues.
Yeah. So is there an alternative? Because I have the presentation.
Did you give it to Jennifer?
It's a Prezi presentation, so she's got the PDF, but she can't run a Prezi, I don't think. Can you, Jennifer?
Hold on, let me check.
But I didn't send her the Prezi.
Hold on.
So is there another Wi-Fi I could use?
Just give me a second.
Yeah, one sec. We would have a workaround if needed.
Well, while we're enjoying our technical difficulties, I can talk to you about the first thing that doesn't require the presentation.
That'd be great.
How about that? So, Mr. Chair and board members, thank you for cramming us into your packed schedule. Tonight, I'm bringing two things to your attention. The first is that we have been unsuccessful in getting anyone to take on the work of getting all of that acreage that we identified into usable, either taxable or useful properties. So I come to you asking if you could create a task force, a committee, a task force, maybe made up with someone from open space, someone from the energy committee, and a couple of assessors, that they could look at all these acres to turn them into productive for the town. So we identified, I think it was like 60 acres up by Eagle Brook that could possibly become carbon sink, benefits to us. And then there's these weird spots all over the place that might work with the open space plan. I don't know, because I'm not entirely certain what they're up to. So it just seemed that maybe a group of people like that, if you just said, do five things a year or something, because I know everybody's kind of overwhelmed, but it would be a shame to lose all that work and to not get that land in productive use, whatever that use might be.
I would agree with that. It is. It's just a matter of bandwidth. So just everybody is tapped out. We'd love to have residents volunteer for our boards. We are lacking in a lot of ways for volunteers. Everybody's busy with their own lives, but we do have all this property that Lily identified that the town owns from many years ago, of all different reasons why we've acquired them over the years. But we've been trying to find ways for people that haven't been at meetings before and hearing this, that we've been looking for ways to use that either as a carbon sink for some of our forestry land or all the other myriad of properties. Do we sell them off? Do we, find different ways? We did have I think 5 years ago, I think just before I got on the board, there was a excess land sale. We sold a few properties and had some homes on there, and so now they're taxpayers and helping the town out. So we're looking, I guess that you're requesting that a group get together to do
that. Yeah, and it seemed like when I was doing the flu clinic, I started talking with a gentleman who was doing open space and went, oh, dope, they should totally be involved.
Yeah.
The energy committee and the assessors. And it just seems like there were properties that are these weird slivers that are abutting farmland that even if we were to say to the farmer, hey, pay us $1,000 for it, because then it's on the tax rolls.
Yep.
Then it's generating income. So there might be some what we call in software development, low-hanging fruit, that could get some impetus around that. But I totally understand. You have the same problem
we do
that I had when we were trying to get folks to take me on. I was just sort of hoping you all have more gravitas than I.
We'll look into it for sure, and okay. We can get people to step on.
I guess I would just like to add that we had a lot of unknown properties as well. We had identified unknown properties, and so we should chip away at that because, again, that's tax dollars as well. So.
Yep, for sure.
Lily, and I have the PDF up.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Say what? We worked very hard on this really cool presentation. It's not the same. Anyway, there it is. That's the technical difficulties. We will return to our scheduled.
Can you send me what you're trying to open?
Well, I will. How about I'll go Bing or something like that. Is that okay?
Switch the page.
It was going to be this like really powerful moment. Anyway, so I would like to talk with you. Our second thing that I would like to bring to your attention is actually much more fun. It's a big idea. Okay. So as we in senior housing explored the various town-owned properties and our vision started to coalesce around the Center Village concept. We realize that there are a lot of committees and organizations with parallel and shared visions for the town, and yet none of them knew what each other were doing.
Yep.
And so we began to actually contact and meet with various committees and committee chairs. And then we realized that people didn't understand what impact their project was having on this over here, and that there was no connection. So it's like we have a race with 20 chariots sort of running all sort of in this general direction and colliding all over the place. And we could have like this, a beautiful carriage with a thoroughbred team driving us along. So it's sort of like a bunch of building blocks just sort of scattered all over the place. And that is an actual representation of the number of boards that we have, probably missing some.
Right.
Okay. And about that much communication between them. So we began talking with the people that we encountered, like Denise, as we were exploring all these different committees. And the idea from all these people is not my idea. This is like a what you call an IKEA headbanging session, was this connecting community initiative. And so Denise is here to explain that. And I'm supposed to be her AV nerd, so I will. So Jen, can you go to the next slide, please? So this is the connecting community initiative. Denise.
Great. Okay. Thanks, Lily. And thank you, Selectboard, for the chance to share this exciting initiative. CCI's mission is to ensure better communication, collaboration, and innovation among boards, committees, town administration, and community members. Communication. Okay. Our first step is to send out a Google survey for committees to fill out about their mission. After gathering this data, we'll create a visual representation and timeline of all that boards and committees are working on. This supports transparency for boards, committees, and the greater community, and promotes a better understanding of the complexities of running the town. I know as a new planning board member, I'm unaware of many of the other committee initiatives. I've also seen posts on Facebook that community members pose many questions and concerns that can lead to frustration and mistrust, unfortunately. CCI creates a platform for transferring institutional knowledge, which is critical to continuity, especially with volunteer boards and committees.
Ding.
Collaboration. By identifying various initiatives, we want to work together more efficiently and effectively and promote greater continuity as committee and board members change. This information brings the shared goals of our community to light. By pulling information, committee and community members will better understand our resources and specific goals and improve funding efficiencies. Innovation. We know that old ways don't open new doors. In my 20 plus years of working with clients on business planning, I emphasize that a business plan is not a static document. On the contrary, it's a living document that acts as a guide to enable one to stay on track with both short and long-term goals. This connecting community initiative parallels a business plan in that our town is not a static entity. It is ever-changing and evolving. CCI supports the dynamic organization of our community. We ask that you create this umbrella committee and empower us to solicit members on your behalf. This will enable CCI to ensure better communication, collaboration, and innovation among Deerfield's boards, administration, committees, and community members as we look towards Deerfield's next 350.
And then the fireworks come up in the real presentation, and it says Deerfield's next 350. Oh, well.
Fireworks. Thank you.
I'm sorry we couldn't get fireworks.
It is a disappointment.
Well, it does sound like an exciting opportunity to pull the different boards together and different committees together that are working on. We've had this conversation offline as well about, you know, I'm on an ad hoc town common committee. We're working on that work. We've got work that we plan to do on the Leary lot. There's park going in. There's all these different things happening, the work the planning board's doing, open space, all this stuff. And it is hard with two staff members
right.
that are completely overwhelmed with all the stuff that it takes to run a town, to manage all of this, telling everybody what
yeah.
we're doing. So it does take volunteers, and it takes a village. It takes people to volunteer, get involved, and start talking about this stuff. And we can communicate and be cheerleaders for it, but we are also overwhelmed. So it's hard to, you know, when you work full time and you do this part time, and it's just, you know, you also have a family and everything else, trying to get it all done has been, it's a lot to do. So we appreciate your involvement in trying to get this stuff moving along. So we would have to come up with a charge and find people to serve on it. You know, the other thing is like, who's going to.
But our thought was that, not surprisingly, there are people who serve on multiple of those committees.
Yep.
So Jen, maybe can you bring up that first one with all the different committee names on it anyway, just to give people an idea. And that if we, and we would be happy to take on this work, the CCI folks, you know, coming up with people to propose to you all with the hope that rather than have 20 people on the committee, we could have fewer people on the committee, but they could speak for multiple
yep.
committees. And it's the idea behind this is to make less work for the committees and for the administration, so that by sharing information, you're also you're everybody's pulling in the same direction. And if somebody's getting a grant, so for example, let's say we get a grant for senior housing and we're going to be building it near the senior center. Well, maybe the landscaping part of the grant for senior housing could conveniently abut the senior center. I mean,
right.
with that kind of shared vision.
I guess the reason why we're proposing it, or I feel like it's very strongly that we need to do this, is because, you know, there's all these different projects going on, and there's not an overall vision. And there's not, like, we went to town hall, I mean, town meeting, and we got $140,000 to do paving.
Yep.
But I'm really hesitant to pave
right.
around the town hall until we have a plan, because why would we want to pave and then rip it up in
right,
a year
right.
or two?
Yep.
And so I think it's really, really important that we have an overall vision. And that's my problem with all these different projects that are going on. I don't have an overall vision of how they all overlap each other and
yep.
integrate with each other. And Denise, when we were meeting, Denise has volunteered. Well, we sort of beat her up. she seemed like a really good choice to share this committee because for, you know, over 18 years, she worked up in Vermont for the Community Action Group. That she was a director of economic development up there. And she taught for over 7 years at Marlborough College, both graduate and undergraduate classes in business management. And she also had her own consulting business. And I feel like she's really qualified to bring people together and do this visioning so that
right.
we're, because we have a very limited resources.
Right.
And so how do we get the maximum dollar for every project efficiently and effectively that, you know, as we can. And so, and yet still accomplish all these things. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, and the senior center is one of them. I mean, are we going to the senior center or are we going to the church? Are we going, you know,
right.
we keep going back and forth. And I have to tell you, it's driving me crazy. And I just want us to have a plan that we can stick to and we start marching. And because
yeah.
you know, when we go down to Boston and we start looking, you know, beating up people for money and put our hands out, you have to have a solid plan and you have to be passionate about what you're doing is the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it just feels like so up in the air at the moment what we're doing. And we have real needs. We've got to get the seniors out of the tent in the next few weeks. We've got to find a place for them. And yes, we have a temporary place, but you know, that is really only for a couple of months, and we need to do something, and we got to get going.
Yep.
And so anyway, Denise, I think, is willing to put in the work. She's capable of doing the work. And I think if we pull all the committees together and we use the synergy of the committees, number one, you've increased the communication down to the committees so people don't feel that they're working in the silo and nobody's listening to them. But also, I just feel that we're going to just, our efficiency level and our ability to get, pull a plan together is going to be so much more enhanced. So I know that this is sort of fast, but I would like us to endorse the concept of this committee. I'd like us to support Denise as chair and then have her come back with Lili and the Senior Housing Committee or whoever wants to come next, our next meeting, and propose how we're going to get this committee working.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to be the right thing to do.
You know, one of the big problems I see is we have an awful lot of committees within the town. Say, no communication, very little continuity. And because of that, I think we're missing out on actually a large number of grants.
Yes.
That the town of Deerfield could be getting. You know, granted, we don't have somebody that can write grants right at the moment, but we're looking at hiring somebody.
Yeah.
And as well as hiring a planner in the future.
Right.
So, but it's just, you know, there's money out there with few strings attached compared to some of the grants that we do get that have a lot of strings and cause administrative headaches for us. So, you know, it's important to get together. You know, it's my pet project right now is this, well, we call it the senior center, but I'm calling it the community center. So
we're working on them.
Yay.
And because,
wonderful.
You know,
yeah.
The sanctuary at the Congregational Church for many, many years was a community center. It has a stage and it was used for a lot of different things.
Yeah.
Over the years, back when, you know, Moby Dick was a minnow. But through the years, you know, it's very good. You know, this was used as a community center at one time because there used to be a stage that pulled out in back of you that's no longer there.
The acoustics must have been awful.
Actually, they weren't as bad as you think.
Really?
Yeah, but so it's important that we get this and we get it going sooner than later. Unfortunately, as a town, I think we've been dragging our feet way too long on some of this stuff. And it's time to grab the bull by the horns and just get it done.
So, I would like to see, I would support this and I would support, I guess, you know, kind of looking at what that charge is. Parameters around this thing,
yeah.
How they communicate with each other. Do we pull one from each board member, you know, committee together? Are those boards willing to do that? Some are elected, some are not elected, so are appointed, some have, you know, so, but I think you won't get 100% buy-in from everybody, but I think the majority, if we get a majority of people rolling in the right direction and all on the same page, we can start moving this stuff forward.
And then once they see how much fun we're having, everybody's going to like
fireworks. So great.
Yes.
We have a hand raised.
Yep.
Okay.
Tim?
Yes, Tim Hilchi. I was speaking with Lili and Denise and Carolyn about this idea because I'm on the CPC as well as the Conservation Commission. And the CPC has a bucket of money that could be used in numerous ways to help finance projects that all relate to a community-centered initiative. And I think everyone agrees that the vision is the thing that's lacking. So, you know, 1 week we're thinking, well, we're going to revitalize the Center Senior and we're going to use it for this purpose. The next week, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to work on another building. And until there's an actual vision, you can't really go out and look for the grants that could make you pay for all of this. So I think the sooner we get this ad hoc or committee in place and figure out how it's going to work, the better for the town. So great ideas.
I have spoken to, I see Julie's on here, Julie Chalfant. I did speak to Julie about this, having the lack of vision and the siloing and how important it is to get people to participate. And I know it's like one more meeting, but again, Julie is, you know, chair of the finance committee.
Is she willing?
Yeah, but she's also on the building committee.
Right, so, yeah.
And so, I mean, I think there's a huge frustration on her part that she's been doing all this work on the building, town building committee, and then it really doesn't go out. It's not spread out for people to use that information. So
that'd be great.
I see her hands up. You could probably
see her hands up. Does that mean she's volunteering?
Yeah. I'm gonna speak first.
Probably, but I don't know what's good. So yeah, just to tailor on to what Carolyn just said, we've done a bunch of background work on both the Town Building Advisory Committee and the Finance Committee. So there's a lot of background information available that I would be to bring and present where we are right now. But just like everybody else, we have all this background stuff, but we need a hierarchy or a priority or something in order to figure out which way to direct efforts next. So yeah, I pretty enthusiastically, depending on how many things there are, be interested.
Well, I think we had talked about like once a month meetings. Mm-hmm. So it is an additional meeting, but I think the efficiency in the long run is going to prove out that this is worth it. And it should actually be less work, I think. And we'll have more of a product in the end. And I think, at least in my mind, the biggest thing is to try to have a vision. And I feel very strongly we've got to do that. Because it's not locked in for me to go out and to be effective.
And until asking how
to get money, right.
Yep.
So, we already know we can't afford to do everything. So,
of course.
By ourselves. So we have to supplement this somehow. And you can't do that unless you have a real idea.
Yeah, Carolyn, I was going to say that, you know, once, you know, Lili, our tech person here, will send out a Google survey, we'll get all the information from the various committees, who's on, what the mission is, and any kind of money that's associated with it. And then we'll, you know, put it all together, and then, you know, everyone will prioritize what will happen.
To make a motion to support the committee and support Jason is the chair until we come back with a.
Can't have a chair.
Say that again.
You need to organize to have a chair. Well, she needs a committee.
Right.
So tag your it.
I sense that you'll wind up being chair, but anyway, gather a committee together to move this initiative forward.
I will second that motion.
Any further discussion? Not hearing any. All those in favor?
Aye, Carol.
Hi, Trevor McDaniel.
Hi, Dave Wolfram.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
We're saying thank you for another committee, but I
yeah,
think
right.
it's a great idea.
I know. Thanks. I really do feel like it's going to be worth it.
Yeah.
Hey, the next thing on is residents of Steam Mill Road discuss no longer maintaining the road beyond public layout. No, leave that there.
Yeah, it'll pick you up.
All right, I'm Jason Billings, 52 Steam Mill Road. I was just trying to maybe hope to shed some light and maybe clear a little confusion about the matter. A few years back, my family had contacted the town about some issues concerning some information on Steam Mill Road, and we got back some confusion about the town's position on the status of the road. And we were trying to make some important decisions for our family at the time. So not getting any information that was going to be helpful for us from the town kind of put us into a position where we decided that we would sacrifice and we would, you know, just pursue that information ourselves. And so we searched kind of far and wide and spent a lot of time, a lot of money finding the type of expert that does this kind of stuff for a living and is regarded very highly in the field of determining status of roads for municipalities in the region, working for both towns and for residents solving these issues. So after we found the right person, approximately a two-year investigation proceeded. And once we had finished up with the investigation, I brought the information in a report from this firm to Kevin and Trevor approximately 2 years ago. And I just let them know what it was, where it came from, what was in it. And I just gave them, you know, a little briefing of everything in there and let them know what was, you know, really important, because the expert's information is pretty, sometimes it's a little hard to go through and understand what exactly is what at the level of what an expert like that would provide. So Kevin and Trevor let me know that they were going to get back to me once they sent it over to the legal team to review it, to see, you know, just to check its validity or whatever, something along those lines. I didn't hear back. I tried to call multiple times, and I was just told that the attorney wasn't finished. They didn't have any information from the attorney for over a year. Finally, I think Casey called me like a year and a half later, and she had said that the town was going to consider something that didn't line up with what was in that report. So I was a little confused at the time. And she said, Jason, you know, it's not going to change anything. It's not going to change, you know, maintenance or any of our town's decisions on the road. But we're just going to have to rely on this document because the town's attorney advised us to do so. I said, okay, so the town's attorney had gotten back to you. So I just kind of mulled that over for a while. And then months later, we get the letter in the mailbox. And attached to it was a report that came from the town's attorneys dated December 2019. I gave the report in the fall of 2019. And the attorney had apparently reviewed everything and came up with a report within a couple months. But for some reason, that information didn't make it back to me after several attempts over the next year and a half. It was quite expensive and quite a sacrifice to come up with that level of information. You know, we knew that these are sensitive matters and the town takes them seriously. So we wanted to make sure that this information came from the most qualified source possible, above a land use attorney, someone who does this in court for a living. And see the letter in the mailbox made me just confused as to, did the town, like, have the people that made the decision on this, did they have this report? Did they read it and did they understand it, or was there any confusion? Because what the town seemed to make their decision based on was a partial layout that was done by Ainsworth in the 1950s, specifically for utility projects the town was doing at that time. That's why it was just considered a partial layout of the road. It addressed partial specifically in the layout. And then Gordon Ainsworth then was continued to be hired for other projects on the road and showed beyond that partial layout the remainder of Steam Mill Road on his continuous surveys, which is shown in the report. And the report probably, the expert who created the report probably wondered if the town might be confused about that layout. So she specifically drafted up a paragraph in that report to let the town know that that layout, multiple layouts can be created on any one town road. So if the town has a project going on and there's confusion or they don't find information in their database that they can hire a surveyor to create a partial layout for a project that they want. They could create multiple layouts on the same road if they want. But that layout does not constitute the status of any other portion of the road or traveled way. If there is another portion of traveled way beyond that layout, the status of that portion of the road would have to be determined by a professional if the town didn't have any records on it. Now, I'm assuming, I've been told multiple times that the town didn't have any information on the southern portion of Steam Mill Road. So I felt like I did a big favor to try to help the situation out, both for myself and for the town, to provide them information, you know, of the highest caliber on what the status of the remainder and entirety of the road was beyond that layout portion. So seeing that that layout was used to determine your decision at the meeting on September 22nd, I'm just not sure if there's any confusion maybe on the town's attorneys that maybe they don't quite understand that that layout doesn't constitute the status of the remaining portion of the traveled way. If it's not on record, which it doesn't seem to be here, then an expert would have to get involved to declare what the remainder of the traveled way is. And that answers, those answers are in that report. So it seems like maybe someone or multiple people didn't understand what might have been in that report and what it really meant, or the gravity of the information there. There's also a thumb drive that was sent to the town's attorneys with supporting documents on top of that report that was sent over a year ago, or approximately a year ago. And there's a lot of supporting evidence beside what's on those thumb drives as well. So it was a little confusing to me as to, you know, when we saw that letter in the mailbox, as to if the town understood what that report really was and if they knew how to interpret it, because it seems like it was not utilized whatsoever in the decision that ended up resulting in those letters.
So I will, is there another person want to speak? Yep, you may. Yep.
Good evening. I'm Andrea Liebson, 41 Steam Mill Road. I've lived on Steam Mill Road for 35 years. I'm the third owner of that house. The house was built in 1977, and it has town water. So I was really surprised to hear that the town was going to discontinue the road when there are town pipes in that area. And for the 35 years I've lived in the house, the road has been maintained by the town. And so we were quite surprised to hear that the town was not going to maintain it anymore. And we wondered what the reasons were. And we have other information about tax base and how much, what the value of our houses is, et cetera. But I believe, excuse me, you may also have that information. So I just wanted to make sure you all knew about that. And there are other residents of Steam Mill Road who might want to.
Of course. Happy to listen to everybody.
Thank you.
Yep. Thank you.
Julie?
Julie Cavaco, North Hillside Road, and I have no interest in the steam mill. But when the discussion came up a couple weeks ago, I remembered that Pecumseh Road was a private road. It was a development that was built in the early 80s, and it was a private road. And X amount of years ago, 12 or 15, the residents were clear that it wasn't a public road. And they had initiative where they got
petition.
They got other townspeople in town potentially to bring a petition to the Board of Selectmen. Then it was voted in at town meeting that Pecumseh Road became a public road. And that is probably the cleanest way to get this to be a public road. It's been established.
Can you please talk into the microphone? Thank you.
No.
to the console.
All right.
Okay. Oh, I was told you can't. Okay. So what I would suggest is that the people get a petition going. I'll sign it. And I bet all the people that are waiting for their roads to be paved with state funds, the town doesn't pay for our paving, that would be the cleanest route with an established way of getting a road that's private put into public. That's all I have to say.
So, okay, go ahead.
Good evening.
Welcome.
Those who don't know me, I'm Mark Russo. I've lived in town for eons, and I live on Steamville Road, and my sister, Norma Gawantner, is the current owner of a nice house out in the area in question. So I'm here in support of my sister. And I think you've got a copy of the one page of my overview of the situation. So I won't belabor it, because some of it will reiterate what Jason has said and so forth. But when that the 1951 layout was done by GE Ainsworth, there was really nothing further south on that road at that point in time.
Yep.
Although it's said in some circles that the road was a county road going back to 1741. We've seen that in the documents and so forth. But since that time, Gordon E. Ainsworth and its successors, C.T. Mayo and others, have done surveys and plans further south of that point. The planning board on at least two occasions has signed off those plans, so clearly there were going to be building lots. So the appropriate town approvals were obtained. Buyers of the lots, you know, invested heavily in their houses and so forth down there, and there was never anything in their permits that said, oh, by the way, this is a private road, it's not a public road. It's usually referred to as Steamville Road, said to be a town-maintained way. So I think, and for years, the town, almost 50 years now, we're closing in on 50 years, the town has maintained the road, plowed the road. And I think to pull it back now to that old 51 layout would really be doing economic harm and emotional harm to the people who have invested down there, gotten mortgages and so forth. So I don't know where the road ends, but I think everybody who's gotten a permit on that road legally and gone through the appropriate processes with the town is entitled to that being a town road that's maintained by the town. If not legally, at least ethically, the way the town of Deerfield has historically and still does today do business. So that's basically, you know, the only point that I have. I'm sure others would like to elaborate.
We can't speak extensively on this subject, but I will. What I will say is that, and just to give some clarity as to why this came about and why we're here, is that. We were asked, is this a town road? We had our attorneys look at that information, and the only thing the town can base its decision and its taxpayer money on maintaining is town roads, and what has the town accepted? And the only legal body is town meeting. And so we go back through the clerk records, and the only record that our town has is what has been accepted by town meeting as to be the layout of 1952. So as none of us knew that, we weren't looking to stop maintenance where we hadn't before, but we were asked, does this town own the road past Gawantner's property and as far south as anything shows back in the 1700s? We asked that question, do we own the road? And our attorney researched it and said, the only thing that you can base it on is what town meeting has accepted. So there's been many layouts, and the only thing that the town is responsible for is what town meeting said, this layout we accept and we will take as a town road. So that's generally where we're at. Now, if the residents, as Julie had mentioned, wanted to take a petition to bring the road up to standards like other, I think, Pecumseh, there's been other roads in town where they've wanted to have the town take over maintenance of a road. If you build a subdivision, the new Sugarloaf Snowberry is a perfect example. They're putting in roads, they're bringing it all up to code, and when they're done, they expect the town to take over those roads. And at that town meeting, the town meeting will decide, the residents will say, yes, we accept this, we're going to take over maintenance of this road, and it's up to code, and here we go. So until we have that, we're caught in a 22, because as you said, ethically, we might want to do something, but we have to be responsible to all taxpayers in the town. So we can only do what the law allows us to do at this time, and that is just to recognize what the town meeting has voted.
I don't know what the legal ramifications are, but it would seem that wouldn't the onus be on the town to discontinue that road? I know when I was more active involved in town affairs, that in front of the town meeting, there'd be votes to discontinue roads beyond a certain point. Apparently, there's never been any vote to discontinue that road down there. I think it's kind of an unfair burden on the residents to have to prove their case.
It is.
50 years of precedent.
Yep.
And the other thing is, wouldn't GE Ainsworth and the others in their plans, when they're doing these, subdividing into building lots that the planning board signed off of, wouldn't they have to say, this isn't a town road? But they all say said to be a town road. And so it's a complex issue. I'd like to think it could be resolved short of the poor citizens down there having to lobby in front of town meeting to get the town to do the right thing. But I'll let somebody else.
Sure.
And again, I'm not an attorney by any stretch of the imagination.
Neither are we.
Thank you.
Happy to, anyone else want to speak on it? Thank you.
No hands up online. Oh, somebody's watching.
I've got somebody here. Yep.
I am Brett Gwanter. And I live in no man's land, which is 90 Steam Mill Road. Just a little history lesson. We own 30 acres, 90 Steam Mill Road, beyond my mom's property, Norma, which is 60 Steam Mill Road. February 6, 1996, we were denied a building permit by then building inspector Richard Asman, because we lacked frontage on a town way. And that was referring to Deerfield zoning bylaws. And the question at that point was for us, well, why were these other residents, at that point there was four houses, why were they granted a building permit? From then we attained legal counsel, presented our case, and basically the town's response was, take us to court or accept the single house variance from the Zoning Board of Appeals. That's what we did. We had to upgrade the road beyond 60 because that was the established maintenance point at that point. Upgraded the road, met all vital access standards, culvert repair, went through all the hoops with the Conservation Commission to make it go. 60 Steam Mill has, in that whole process, there was never a question that was the point where the town stopped maintaining the road. During our litigation, ownership of the road was never questioned. There was four houses, and since then, and perhaps one of the biggest points of growth in Deerfield, we've had another, I think in the last 15 years, another four houses added. So to piggyback on Mark's comments, I feel like we, the residents, those permits were issued by the town building inspector. They are a town employee. That is negligence on the town. So we are being punished because of that negligence. I don't think anybody in this room is looking for a paved blacktop road. I think we are looking for continued plowing, sanding, grading twice a year, and an occasional roadside mowing. That's all we've had in the 25 years up there. So I have a hard time with the board's position that, hey, you guys got to prove it, you got to take it to vote. I think 50 years of maintenance is proof enough. And I guess I ask Trevor, David, and Carolyn to do the right thing here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brett.
Hi, I'm Norma Galanter, Brett's mom.
Welcome.
I'm the oldest one on the road, okay? I just want to introduce myself a little bit. I am a third generation Russo, and my father settled here in 1914 on Steam Mill Road. And growing up, we rode our bikes up and down. My mother would always say, go to Harry's camp, turn around. The woods are too thick, don't go any further. That was always, in my generation, the end of the road. And then I built a house, 14 Steam Mill Road, raised my four kids. And of course, we didn't have public gyms back then, so the kids would work out. They were all into sports, running up and down Steam Mill Road. And I would echo the same comment, do not go beyond Harry's camp, which is still there, hidden in the woods. So in 2007, my husband and I bought Phyllis Child's property. That was 60 Steam Mill Road. Nice. And, she built it in the late 60s, and we went through all the paperwork, and we did not do anything until my husband passed away a couple of years ago. And I came to the building inspector in 2019, and of course, I was a new widow, and honestly, that department was wonderful. They guided me through the paperwork, and I really could not thank them enough. They were terrific. So I got my permit, and everybody on the street, we have our own wells, we have our own septic systems, and I have been in my house for a year and a half, and when I received the letter with no explanation, I thought, oh my God, how does this happen?
Right.
They would have never given me a permit. I mean, they were wonderful. And I was told that I didn't do enough research. If I had researched, I would have found it was not a town road. And I immediately went up to the courthouse and got a copy of my deed, and it does say I am bounded to Steam Mill Road. So if it's not a road, who owns the road? And I think at this point, as kids, we were on that road all the time, and they always plowed it. In fact, one little story I have to tell you, Brett's sister, who was a really Star Trek gal, the crown was so perfect, she'd run up the right side and come down the left and then reverse it, because she said, Mom, I've got to have the same exercise on each side of my body. And it was always maintained fine, and we loved it. Yeah. So I hope you can resolve the problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Sure. Anybody else?
You need to come to the mic, Chris.
Come to the mic so people can hear you on the thing. Just say your name and who you are and what you're doing.
I'm Chris Mason. I'm one of the residents that live on Stevenson Road. One of my questions is the documentation of the report done by Holmberg and Howe. I saw it. I read it. It seems to make perfect sense to me. One of my questions would have to be, have you guys had a chance to look through that information, or did you not have any part in the process of reading through that report? It seemed like you got, from the last meeting that we watched, it seems like you got a copy of it the night of the meeting, and it seems like there's so much important information in that report It seems odd that you wouldn't have been, had a chance to review that before making such a drastic vote. So, I mean, if that's a question you could answer.
It's not.
It isn't. Okay.
No, it's not.
And because of the information that's in that report, Jason's family is the one who paid for that report. So is it possible for me to give him the more time so he can explain more about the report?
We're happy to listen. I just, again, okay, our hands are a bit tied at the moment. We're here to gather information and take it under advisement.
Is it possible for you to tell us who the expert was that actually rebutted the report that Jason provided?
Town council, and they don't rebut the report. All they do is gather information on behalf of the town. So they don't,
okay,
they're not, their job isn't to rebut and say whether his stuff is valid or not. It's about what did the town accept,
okay,
at town meeting, and that is it.
Sure. Would it be okay if Jason has time after I finish with me, with what I'm saying, or is it?
Take your time.
Okay.
I mean, I don't want to rush anybody.
Well, I guess really what it boils down to is I prepared my speech quite a few times. The first one was angry because I was really unsure as to why this was happening. I've lived up on Steam Mill Road for 4 years now. There was never any mention of this ever being a private way, and it sounds like from the last meeting that I listened to, Kevin Scarborough, the town superintendent, he did mention that this project has been in the works for 4 years. It took 4 years to try to get this. He said it takes 4 years to get this off the maintenance list.
Well, can I just answer a little bit of the timing on this?
Is
that,
sure,
we've had COVID, so, and there's a lot of other things that are going on. So I,
okay,
do remember a year into my service here, Jason talking to us about it, and then,
okay,
our attorney went back and researched the information, and then we had a transition in staff in the office, and then COVID hit. So there's been a lot of like falling down,
sure,
I would say, on our part here at the town.
And
but
I completely understand that.
That's pretty much where the time
slowed everything down. You have to realize that I'm coming from a place, I have two small kids. The only thing I really care about is them.
Mm-hmm.
And the financial position that this potentially puts me into. So when I hear that this has been going on for 4 years, COVID or not,
mm-hmm,
this is a huge, not only does this affect us financially, they keep bringing up the fact that if the town gets brought up to safety spec, which implies to me that the road is not up to safety specs now, which means the... It's not accurate?
No.
Oh, so could we do the petition to, I thought you said once we have to bring it up to safety specs, so we could do a petition to get the road accepted back onto the list?
It has to be up to subdivision.
Subdivision, it's not a safety,
okay,
spec, it's just a subdivision,
okay,
requirement, yep.
Okay. It just seems like in 4 years, COVID or not, there could have been some sort of letter saying, hey, we're looking at the status of Steam Mill Road. I built my house 4 years ago. I pulled a building permit in that office over there. Never was there any question of whether or not this was a private road, a private drive, or anything like that. There's no land trust established or HOA established that we would be putting money into to maintain this road. The town has been maintaining it I haven't been there that long, but it sounds like 70 plus years. My property map, my plot plan said to be a town way. My neighbor is on town water, and hers said to be a town way maintained by the town. For you to say that we should, and I got the same thing when I came down to discuss this. I said, you know, why is this happening? I was told, well, this is your fault. If you had done due diligence.
We wouldn't say it's your fault.
Well, you weren't there.
I know.
Because of the town administrator.
Anyway.
If I had done my due diligence, I would have found one sentence from a meeting in 1952 that said, we accept this partial layout of the road. It just seems really, it seems awful odd that this is even coming up. No, it. I don't know. I guess I got nothing else to say, really. It just seems like, you know, the last thing that Kevin Scarborough said at that meeting was, we're not going to hang anybody out to dry. I'm sure you heard that. It just seems like waiting 1 month before the snow is going to come and telling people that all the liability of the road, all of the plowing, all of the maintenance, and he mentioned culverts and drainage is all going to fall on the 7 residents that live there. And then to tell us 1 month before it's going to snow that that's all our responsibility when it never has been in the past, and there's never been any mention of this in the past. It seems like these people, these two, I could tell that they weren't aware of that report. And it seems like to take a vote at that puts such a financial burden on their taxpayers like this, just seems wrong. And it doesn't seem right to do to us. And I moved back to this town because I wanted to live here. And I guess I'm questioning my life choices at this point. So thank you.
You're welcome. Anybody else speak?
Hi. Not much.
Welcome.
So my name is Michelle Matrowski. I live at 36 Steamill Road. I bought the piece of property from Norma and Ted, which are amazing people, back in, I think, 2014. Well, we were planning on going to retire and build a house on that land. 2015, my husband had a glioblastoma. Oh. So we were told he had 3 months to live. So we decided, oh, we've got to build. So we built the house. We had looked at other properties prior to that, and they were all HOAs, private roads, and I'm like, hell no, I'm not going to deal with that. So when we went to build, we had no problems. We were never aware and or told that it was a private road because we never would have bought the property. It was too much of a financial burden for myself. And we decided, like, we have to get this done. And the day I broke ground, Danny died. So it's just myself in this house, and it's a financial burden if this happens. And I don't think I'll be able to keep it if it happens. Mm-hmm. So it's very frustrating.
Thank you for sharing.
Hi, I'm Sean Herenda. I live on Steam Mill Road. So if it's a private road now, are we at fault if someone gets hurt on our road? So there's kids from DA and Eagle Brook that jog up and down that road all the time. People are walking. Do we now have to put a sign up and say, you can't come up here anymore? Because now if somebody gets hurt, then is it our responsibility?
Can't answer that today. Good question.
We don't actually know who owns the road.
Jason Billings again. I'm just going to allude on to what I was talking before in a little bit more detail. That report from Holmberg and Howe proves that that road is a town way. It refutes what the attorney is saying about this layout. The attorney is saying, even to you guys, what you're telling us right now, that the town can only accept something legally or lawfully if it's an accepted way at a meeting. What people are missing that's in that report is that in the 1740s, that road was laid out lawfully, legally, and correctly by the town. Then, later on, after the Revolutionary War, when all the laws changed, in order for that town road to maintain its town road status, it would have to be transferred to the town in one of three ways. One of those ways is through prescription. It's what's called a prescription where the town actually has to sit down and prescribe that road that was already laid out properly over to the new town government. That happened. It's actually pretty rare on a road this old for that type of documentation to exist. But knowing that the town missed this the first time is not... it's not surprising because that road is so old and it has been a town road for so long that information was in historic Deerfield. It wasn't here. So when the attorney's referring to, we have to only go by this layout that was accepted at town meeting, or we can only accept anything, anything that was laid out at town meeting, she must not have read the report, because that town road was laid out at town meeting. It was just in an older document. It doesn't look like the new documents we see today, but it holds the same lawful legal weight in court that the new documents do. So when the town keeps saying that there's no layout beyond the 1950s layout, it's absolutely incorrect. There is a layout, and it's lawful and legal, even though it looks a little bit different than more of the modern layouts do. It was also prescribed over to the town in a legal and lawful manner. That's been clarified. There's no fuzzy information surrounding it. So what I think is going on is, I think that where you're getting your guidance from is, the attorneys you're getting your guidance from are either confused or they're not sure what they're looking at. So if you guys need more clarification on that, or the attorney needs more clarification on that, I can help them, and I can point them in the direction of experts at a higher level who understand this clearly. So I would hope you would take that information into account to understand that even though the attorney's telling you something, the attorney's missing something, and it's in that document. It is the town way, all the way to essentially to where Camosas Field hits. It's never been closed, and it was laid out properly at town meeting. There's an official, lawful, legal layout for that road as a town road from the 1700s, and then it was prescribed over properly 100% legally and lawfully to this day as it stands. So there's some confusion there, Trevor. I don't know if you missed that, or if the attorneys might have missed that part, but there's no confusion over it because the information is there. The attorneys, I'm assuming you said you were going to give them that information. I'm sure that they saw it. So I don't know if they were confused or they didn't quite know how to read that report. But that report clarifies and fixes this whole issue. It was 100% legally laid out at town meeting, and it was 100% prescribed over legally and lawfully to today's standards. So I hope you just take that into consideration, because it's really an easy solution to all of us on the road, and it's rare to have that kind of conclusive legal and lawful documentation on a road that old, and it wasn't easy to get it.
Thank you. I guess I'd like to give my personal opinion. I understand your stress completely. And I just want you to know that I am very sympathetic with everybody. However, we were advised to use the 1952 layout because we can't use taxpayer money on private way. I would like us to keep working on this, to come up with some way to keep the status quo. In other words, not improve the road to subdivision standards, but just do what we're doing now, plowing, grading once in a while, and that kind of thing. You all have been paying taxes. You've all bought into your house. I'm 100% supportive of that. When the town gave a waiver to Brett to build his house, in my mind, we terminated the road at 60 Steam Mill River. I mean, still Steam Mill Road, because he then took on as a private way. So to me, our obligation really ends at number 60. I feel, you know, we had to vote on this as recommended by our attorney, but I would like to see some resolution, some way that we could continue to maintain what we are doing, the status quo, because I'm 100% sympathetic with everybody.
So you're talking about possibly maintaining up to 60.
Yes.
But that really.
But my question is, right now, someone's going to fall through the ravine. There's a big piece of the road missing. You left it a mess before you turned it over, quote, temporarily or whatever. So now we have this major hole. It needs a obviously it needs a bigger culvert and it needs drainage. The road's never been maintained since the town did it 50 years ago. The only fellow that did it right was the old guy back in the late 70s, 80s. I forgot what his name was, but you have to grade that mountain where the water comes off. You put a ditch in there. There's culverts everywhere. What do? They push it into the woods and keep flattening it and flattening it so all the water runs down the road and into the ravine. So there's a, it's an issue that once it's properly, the town probably should have hired someone with some skill that would know how to grade that road. And once it's graded and rounded over, the maintenance is virtually nothing except for the plowing and maybe, you know, coming through with a grader. But the issue is that the road has, like, been left in a mess, too. So what happens if someone falls in the ravine? Do we all have to pay for it in this meantime? That's my question. I'm very concerned. And Eagle Brook's not coming on the road. I'm going to put a sign up. All those joggers and everybody, if we're maintaining the road, they don't get to go on it. But the whole issue is it's really a road anyway, so we shouldn't have to be, you know. But if those kids get hurt, they're running down the road 3-4 abreast and they fall in the ravine, there's an issue of liability. And I think your attorney should get back to us right away. Because that's a pretty big thing to worry about. You don't sleep at night if you think you're going to be liable for someone getting hurt. You know, there's like mountain bikers and all kinds of people who come through there. Oh, if there's a question of liability, then kind of a mess because we're stuck. We didn't have insurance. What if somebody got hurt a couple days ago? I mean, you have to, if we have responsibilities for that, then we have to figure out something. But the whole issue is it should be maintained. And with a little bit of extra maintenance to begin with, a lot of the issues would be resolved. Well, I've lived there 36 years or so, 37. And, you know, we never had issues before. Plus, there's a lot of heavy Deerfield Academy equipment going in and out. You know, heavy equipment makes a difference on a road. You know, a lot of traffic. That's my issue anyway.
Thank you.
And I also feel that if we're not, if that road doesn't get maintained, then we shouldn't be paying our full taxes. Like everybody else in town gets a, they have their own sewer systems, they have their own paved roads, and all we want is a little bit of maintenance on our road, and it seems kind of sad to take money. I get the feeling we're gonna be paying for the park instead of our road. They're trying to get money out of somewhere. But anyway, that's my thoughts.
Thank you for coming.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We got a lot of meeting to go.
Heard my memory a little bit further, but I really appreciate that you folks have a real tough job, and your contribution to the town is definitely appreciated by all of us. But back to the tax, and just on the structures, the lots that have buildings on them down in that area, you've got over $3 million in tax assessed value right now, generating in excess of $50,000 a year in tax revenues to the town. So there's some nice houses down there that generate a significant amount of tax value. I think the point that the value, if it, for God forbid, it does become a private way, the values rightly would be quite a bit less. So the only hope that I have personally is that it didn't require, you folks were able on your own authority to all of a sudden say, oh no, the road's going to be capped right here. I'd like to think on your own authority that you could come to a decision that will resolve this short of us having to go to town meeting to duke it out there. So thanks.
Thank you very much for coming. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jamie Billings. I live at 52 Steam Mill Road. It seems like we're really overcomplicating this issue. And my question is, the attorney for the town is making this decision based on her opinion, not an expert's opinion. So I'm wondering, why is she choosing to use the 1952 layout over an expert?
I'm not going to speak for the attorney, but I think it's based on case law. So I think she's looking at case law, and I think that case law has to do with sometime in the 1800s, towns had to start to accept roads,
it is proved that Steam Mill Road is a road. Yeah. Back in the 1700s.
I can't argue with you back and forth on
I'm not
that.
Arguing. I'm just asking.
I can't answer for the attorney. All I can say is what opinion she gave us, and she instructed us to do to make sure that the town accepted what was legally accepted by the town meeting. And if town meeting accepts the rest of the way, we'd be happy to support that.
So how do we do that?
And just take a petition to town meeting. Oh, here, you go.
There is actually a
process. This is where the
and I mentioned that a couple of times. I think I mentioned it to Chris Nathan as well. The process is the road and the specifications are required. You have to fix the road. Request that the board
fix the road.
Bring the road up to specifications.
Okay, so hold on 1 second. So the town has been maintaining this road this whole time. You're going to tell us it's not a town road, and now you're going to tell us that we have to bring it up to specification?
I'm outlining the process.
Oh.
So may I finish?
Okay, we don't need to finish.
We don't need to finish.
Moving. Do you have anything else you want to say? Okay. Any other comments?
Okay. As you know, and as you can understand, we represent the town of Deerfield. We're between a rock and a hard place right now. The report doesn't mean anything to me. I have to go by what our legal opinion is from our attorneys. That's what we're bound by. I know, and I appreciate what you're saying, but until we get a different opinion, we're prohibited from using public funds on a private way. And the attorneys have, but I'm just saying, the attorneys have told us this is a private way. So we have to go by that.
How do we get a new town attorney?
Excuse me. Person in the audience, if you would like to speak, please move to the microphone.
Go to the microphone. Nobody can hear you.
But you have to be recognized by the chair.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think we all have a lot of questions for this town attorney, because this town attorney has provided information above her expertise level that she's seemingly ignoring.
Here again, let's stop right there, because you don't know the expertise level of the attorney group that
we're using.
I
actually do.
So, technically a town employee, okay? So stop there. You may not agree with her opinion, and that is your right. But we are bound by what we are told by this group right now. This is what we have to go by. And I totally appreciate, you know, I've known the Russo since, years and years. And it's just, and I fully appreciate where you're coming from. But we are bound, because what happens if we start maintaining this public way, we open a Pandora's box with a lot of people that have private ways within the town of Deerfield say, well, if you're doing this one, you got to do mine. So we got to be careful on this. Once we got that legal opinion, it kind of puts us in a very tough spot.
Yeah, I understand. Mike, I think there's going to be multiple people concerned about this one new topic now, is that if there are taxpayers that are concerned about the decisions that the town attorney's making, how do we take some recourse over that? Because we would think that our elected officials would take information like that in that report from a higher level of expertise than the town attorney, that I know for a fact, And the town attorney is disregarding it at the taxpayer's expense. We're, us taxpayers are going to have to do something about that. Because we would hope that you guys would step in and say, let's take a look at this report and see if there is a legal lawful layout from the 1700s and see if there's legal lawful prescription that happened.
There is a county layout. We know there's a county layout, but it was never accepted by the town of Deerfield.
If you look at the report, you'll find
accepted by the town of Deerfield at town meeting.
You'll find in that report that it was. I don't know what you've looked at for documents, but the report lets you know that that happened. So I don't know why that keeps getting ignored here. So I don't know if this is a town attorney issue or not, because it's not very difficult to understand. All of our neighbors like have looked at that report, and they seem to understand that very clearly, what constitutes the legality of what a town has to accept. That's understood by us. And so is the report. And you're saying that you're not going to take information from that report and make a decision on it. You're only going to take information that is telling you something different than that report. When somebody normally has a question about the context of a road in town, the first thing you do is you send them to Kevin Scarborough. Kevin Scarborough does a little research if necessary, and he comes back and gives his opinion on it. Well, that report is like a bonanza of opinion. Like, you're lucky to have that information. Not that much information is had on many of the roads in town. So for you not to wait, for you to make decisions, critical decisions on other roads in town with less information, now you're handed this very valuable document that costs thousands of dollars and years to create. Why would you not use that to make decisions when you use far less all of the time to make decisions?
We have our attorney make the decision. That's what we're up to. That's what we have to do.
Okay.
That's what we have done.
Okay.
So we'll take your information under advisement and move on.
Can we have an answer to the attorney's reading of that provision where it says it's prescribed?
Please come up to the microphone.
Keep your hand up.
All right, so at this point.
No, don't talk yet. Wait till you're at the microphone. Thank you.
We can't hear you.
So at this point, the road is technically not up to code. Is that where we're at? So if Brett has a fire at his house, the fire department's not coming at this point.
Okay, let's get one thing clear.
We can't speak.
The water district and fire district in your area is not part of the town of Deerfield.
Never has.
It's a fire
so
water
I
district.
So I guess we're all, I mean, I'm just concerned with how does, like, what happens now?
We
like,
tried
what
to
do we,
say that.
But I mean, but so I understand where she's saying that we have to then maintain, bring the road up, but we have to come up with the money to now maintain the road? Is that what you're saying? Is basically it, until we do that, we have nothing.
All I have is what the attorney has given us.
No, but I mean, I'm just trying to be
we'll
practical.
We'll take
like,
your information.
Do.
I would suggest, I know you have a lot of questions. I would write them down and send them to us.
Yeah.
We can forward them to our attorney and get a ruling on that. Because we're not going to solve anything today.
But so if it snows tomorrow, we're plowing the road. We have to find someone to do that. Is what you're? I mean, I'm just trying to figure out
at
like
this
what happens.
Moment,
happens
yes.
What do we do? You know, like,
at this moment, that's what I have. But luckily, it's not going to snow tomorrow. But
we're not going to have an answer by the snowfall.
Right.
That's
I don't
true.
Know that. I don't know if it's going to snow tomorrow.
I feel like we have. I think.
Where did they stop tomorrow?
1400. 50 feet at the moment.
I think it's right at Andrea's. It's number 41. Isn't
no,
that
before my it's before my house. Andrea Leibson, 41 Steam Mill Road. If this was 4 years in the decision making, why have none of the Steam Mill Road residents been informed of this? We didn't find out anything about this until we received the letter. So if you thought that
we had no idea. We had no idea until Mr. Billings asked that we improve the road all the way down to his property.
No, I did not, for the record, ever ask you that. I volunteered to do that work for the town, and that's all I said about that.
Excuse
you asked if it was
me.
A town road.
Can you please come to the mic if you're going to speak?
All I'm saying, here, let's write this down. Questions come down. No, we're done, Jason.
Okay.
Write letters. Write that information. Pass it on to us. We can pass it on to the attorney and try and get an answer for you on a specific question. But we can't continue to belabor this tonight because we don't have all your answers for you. The only answer we have is what is bound by our attorney at the moment.
Sounds like you're willing to reconsider based on what you've heard.
I haven't heard anything different from where my position was before. My position before was I'm 100% sympathetic, and I feel like we should try to figure out a way to maintain the status quo. We were forced into this decision because we were being asked to extend the road. And
who asked you to extend the road?
I thought it was your request.
That was very clear. I never asked you to extend the road. I asked for what the status of the road was from the town's point of view.
And that's when we got our attorney involved, and that's when she came up and said we're using public money to maintain a private way. And so that's why we were forced to vote this.
There's some really, really important confusion going on here, because if this all came about because somebody told you guys or somebody believed that I asked for that road to be extended or maintained, that was a complete fabrication. There was no such request ever asked. I approached the town, and there was a piece of property for sale just south of Brett Guanter. Multiple people looked at that property to buy it. Pete Kalaszewski went out, passed a perk test for a building lot on it, then taxed that at building lot tax rates. They were getting a bunch of misinformation from the town, so those buyers kept hitting the road. The seller was very frustrated about it. My family ended up buying that lot, so I wanted to see what the town's position was on that road.
Well,
and the town wouldn't give me an answer, so that's when I hired the professional. I told the town if I were to build on that lot in the future, that I would assume the maintenance responsibility to bring that section of the road up to code myself. I offered to do that for the town, and now I'm hearing the town telling multiple people at this meeting that I requested that the town extend that road or provide maintenance on that road or to reconstruct that road. That's completely false.
Well,
I told the town that I'd be willing to do it for them on top of spending thousands of dollars in 2 years of my time to give you information on figuring out what our town road was, which is clearly demonstrated in that report. That's all I have to say.
I have an email, but okay.
We have a hand up online.
Oh, I just have a quick question, I think, that
online?
We're kind of done
yes.
with the topic. But what is...
All right, Greg, hold on.
Can we petition to have the town council review again or something along those lines so that we could... maybe move in the direction of trying to maintain the plowing and the sanding as we have been in the past? Is there, what can we do to help improve our situation without being at a standstill?
I personally, this is just my opinion. We obviously haven't voted anything, but I feel very strongly that we do have an obligation because we have been collecting taxes and we have been maintaining. It's just my personal opinion. But again, Brett made it in the 1995. His waiver and his zoning board approval to build his place ended our obligation to that road. It's a private way from 60 on.
And
I think that's very clear. You know, the town is not obligated to do anything beyond that. And, you know, so we have to do this legally.
Yep.
You know, we're constrained by what our lawyer is telling us to do. I feel that maintaining the status quo is appropriate. You all have been paying taxes. People bought their houses. That's what I feel. I feel like we need to work through that, and I hope that can be resolved before the snow flies.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would encourage Dave and Trevor to ask our attorney and try to come up with some kind of solution. But anything beyond that, I mean, I do have Brett's copy of his deeds where he has his property. There, it doesn't even mention Steam Mill Road. So I feel very strongly that we have no obligation beyond number 60.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel that, you know, we didn't have a choice to vote because that was a recommendation by our lawyer. And I know how awful it is to get those, you know, the kind of letters in the mail and all that kind of stuff. But we've got to figure out something, and we'll, you know, try to work to resolve it somehow.
Is there anything that we can do as residents? I think even getting it back to 60 would be a huge improvement over where it is right now, seeing the orange pins that are near my house. So, you know, what can we do to help the board at this point? Because, you know, we realize where you are and what the position is.
You all came out tonight, and you impressed upon us that you are all concerned. I think, you know, we're not awful. We understand, you know, and all of us, if we were in your position, we would be doing the same thing, saying, like, you know, come on, we got to work on this. So I think, you know, the message is clear. We'll work with our attorneys to see if there's some way that we can come, you know, figure out a way to maintain what we were doing. And it is minimal. I live on a minimal road as well, but I kind of like it that way. So I'm fine. And, you know, if we have to have a way to limit our liability, our own liability. So, you know, if we can do this, maintain the status quo of what we were doing, if there's a legal way to do it, I would like us to see if we can.
We would be very appreciative.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Sorry, you can have questions. I interrupted.
Jennifer, you have somebody online?
Greg Franceschi.
Can you hear me?
Go ahead. Yes.
Yep, I can hear you, Greg.
I'm just curious whether the lawyer, it sounds like the lawyer did not have access to the document that was referred to that clarifies that the town meeting approved the road. Is that not true?
She did.
They had all the documentation.
Is that all?
Anything from anybody that we have not heard from yet?
Nobody online.
Okay. Sure.
I am Victoria Lazinski. I had owned a piece of property up there, which we sold a few years ago to Mr. Billings. We were paying for a building lot, tax-wise, for many, 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 many years. So you guys maintained minimally. What did you do with all that money that you charged everybody a building lot tax-wise? Just out of curiosity.
What the assessors, you know, you receive your tax bill. If it's not appropriate or you've been overtaxed, that's the abatement process. So, you know, that whatever you were paying is between you and the assessors. Not
just me. All these people were paying.
Yes.
And all of them with the thought that maybe someday, if they did put a house up there, that maybe could have had a little bit of maintenance. So you paid it with that thought in mind. And you're saying, oh, we can't use public people's money to do this. We are public people, and we are paying taxes. Why is this all of a sudden, boom, we're not doing it?
Well, I think the town just found out where the layout was ended. I mean, I assumed it was to number 60.
Well, I was just wondering off the top of my head how many years we've all paid into these taxes and where that money went, because, of course, you plow a little tiny bit. That couldn't have cost as much as the taxes that you charged. That's all I'm saying.
Moving on. Okay, we thank you for your input on this. We will be, if you submit your questions to the town, we'll submit those to our lawyer. As we said, they had the documentation that you submitted earlier, and we'll advise you of what we can come up with or what an alternative plan may be. You know, like I said earlier, right now, because of the lawyer's findings, we're between a rock and a hard place. And when they declared that part of the road is a private way. So until we can get clarification on that, it's still going to be a private way, unfortunately.
Have you get clarification if it's only the attorney or
Thank you for your input.
Okay.
So the next.
Why don't we go down to the CC Deerfield Natural?
Julie was here.
Candace?
No, Julie. Candace isn't coming. She has a conflict.
Oh.
Julie didn't come in to talk about the job description.
Okay.
I can describe what that is, or you can go down and do your discussion items. But I will tell you, Candace does want your blessing.
I'd like to go down to Deerfield Natural because they've been here.
Oh yeah.
Go to what?
To that's one development, I think.
Oh, or one development, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Or whoever they're for.
Who yeah, is for the property.
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
Which one are we doing?
The
Oxford.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, we're going to now discuss the Oxford property RFP response for review and possible approval. Gentlemen, want to step forward?
Guys, how you doing?
Good.
Introduce yourself.
Sure. I'm Jeffrey Ethier, president of NewPro in Whately, technically, but we're using the South Deerfield mailing address.
Sure. I'm Derek Healy from One Development and Construction, just acting as an owner's rep, helping these guys out with the RFP process.
Thank you.
You should be familiar with us.
Yes.
Built the Dumont building across from the property that they're hoping to obtain. I will say I've been working with Jeff and Victor for over 3 years to try to help them accomplish their dream of building a new facility, and it feels good to finally be where we are at.
I'm Victor Vasenko. I'm the managing partner of NewPro LLC. Welcome.
Do you want to present your proposal?
Well, I can. You want me to go over it a little bit?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so we had an RFP that Andrea Woods from FERCOG had facilitated for us for the piece of property, kind of, that, well, actually two pieces of property. The town will remember we kind of split off about an acre or so on the northerly western side of the lot, and this is all the property that's left in the Oxford property. One Development had done a very good job developing the Dumont property, and then we have the town highway garage on the other property, and the large chunk that is left we've been hoping to sell, and it's taking us a little too long through COVID and all to get the surveying done and easements for our sewer done and splitting the property off, because we had understood there was some interest in another section. But looking over the RFP, there were two properties for sale, and NewPro has put a bid in on both properties. And I think their intention, I thought from the letters, were that if you didn't get both properties, you probably wouldn't move forward with the project. You kind of needed both for the size and layout of the building that you. What's that again?
And possible expansion
in the future. And so looking at the proposal, it is to consolidate your business on that property and build a fairly large building that would produce
You might have to help me with this, but it's film, right?
Plastic.
Plastic,
yep.
Used in manufacturing and all. So, and the idea is to kind of consolidate the business and hopefully grow and expand the business there and produce jobs and a good tax base for Deerfield. So I had reviewed the letter of intent and on both properties, and they met all of the requirements that we had, the RFP, about, you know, producing jobs and being a, you know, a taxable business and, you know, using the parcel, and so it met all of our requirements. And so just speaking personally before we move on, is that I'm in favor of approving the sale, and they've made a bid for both properties that, it, you know, kind of fit about where we were thinking we needed to pay back some of the money that we had purchased back the property from previous owner. I mean, I think it's a good fit for Deerfield. I'm really excited that you guys have wanted to move here and make your home here. And I know you're not that far away, but right. to consolidate in our neck of the woods would be great and produce jobs here. And, you know, we'll have another old process of expedited permitting because the select board oversees that parcel. So we'll go through that at some point. But I would... I'll let you speak, but I'm in favor of moving forward with these.
I'm in favor of it as well, so yeah. I would be glad to make a motion.
Obviously I'm in favor of it. I've been in the plastics and urethane industry for 42 years, so just retired in July, so I started at Deerfield Plastics, so, and then progressed through. Saw what that location did for this community. It employed a lot of people in the area, provided livelihoods. Paul is behind you. His father worked at Deerfield Plastics for years and years. 35. And, you know, at the time I was at Deerfield Plastics, Deerfield Urethane was in the same building. So I had a lot of contact with that, and I actually finished my career at SWM, but which both of you know about.
Right.
But I'm very excited about it. And it's I think it's the type of industry Deerfield needs. It's a clean industry.
Right.
Because of the value of what you're doing, you have a very small waste stream and low impact, and I can only see benefits to the town. So
I agree 100%. I would make that motion that we
accept both bids.
Both bids.
Great. I'll second that motion. Okay.
Any further discussion? Hearing none?
Yes.
We have to vote on each one?
Yeah, I think probably we should do that. I'm just going to quickly.
Okay. I would make a motion to accept the bid for. I think we should probably list them out separately.
Property 2-1 and property 2-2.
I was looking for the dollar amount.
$450,000. I make a motion we accept $450,000 for parcel 2-1.
Yep.
I'll second that. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye, Carolyn.
Aye, Chuck McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
I make a motion that we accept $62,500 for parcel 2-2.
I'll second that motion. Trevor McDaniel.
Okay. Any further discussion? Not hearing any. All those in favor?
Aye, Carolyn.
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
The plan is to, if successfully awarded, immediately New Pro to perform environmental review and analysis of the site, investigate on-site wetlands, consult soil scientists. This due diligence phase will last until early December 2021. Engineering and architectural design January through February 2022. Submit site plan for zoning board approval March 2022. Begin construction April 2022 and project completion January 2023.
I don't believe you have to go to the zoning.
No, because it'll
this
be.
This is all under us.
It'll all be expedited through the permit.
So it all goes to planning board.
Yeah.
That's correct.
All right through here, the select
yep.
board.
You just have to come to us so you can modify your timeline anytime you want.
Yep.
Oh, of
we'll
course.
Be glad to.
We have to go through the purchase and sale first. To
yeah.
Quit.
Yeah.
Lawyers will do their thing.
That's why I built that time in the beginning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Verbal length of process.
Great. Yeah. There's a PSA here.
Sometimes lawyers have different opinions on things.
Yeah. So, that's right.
As we just heard.
As we just heard.
An hour and a half.
This is a degraded site, so you shouldn't have any real issues with any, delineations or anything like that, a wetland. So when you're ready, you can just get on our agenda, and we can do site plan review with you.
So there's a whole process in the EPP
oh,
part.
Yeah, I'm
what I would
say. Yeah,
it's similar.
With all
that. You've already been.
I'll be utilizing Pony from SV.
Oh, great.
Again,
yeah.
So
great.
It should just be a streamlined process for us.
Right, but you can. You just have to. You know, it's just us. So. What we're concerned about is, you know, it's a residential neighborhood, so having a loading dock that is angled in, mm-hmm. you know, away from residents.
You can see kind of the loading docks kind of mirror the west side of the property, I guess.
Yep.
Along the well-wooded boundary. We didn't do it right next to the DPW because we know how close it is to the residences there.
Yep. Thank you.
So employee parking would be along that parcel, but obviously when we get into the design phase, we'll take in consideration site lighting and light pollution.
Yep.
Their business is fairly quiet, so there should be no issues with noise pollution. Most of their deliveries, if not all of them, come during the normal working hours,
good.
Right? So
good.
You won't have truck traffic at night.
Right.
That's going to be big.
Multiple shifts, so they will have cars coming in and out at night.
Yeah.
But besides that, I think it's a great job for
perfect
down at Deerfield, right?
Yeah.
So we're excited to
standard format. Over 50% of your traffic is going to be just during the day, though, right?
Right.
Yep.
Exactly.
That's
fair.
Yep.
Great. Low impact with that. So
looking forward.
Very excited.
Yep.
Yeah.
We are very excited. Thank you so much.
Thank
so
you.
So who will be the contact for starting to initiate the? Okay.
Casey, yeah,
all right, good.
Casey Warren, yep.
Right.
You that would be
grab
me.
A card or grab a card before?
I'll go grab a card.
Okay, thank you. That'd be great. Yep. Her and Jen will help.
It's your timeline, basically. Once the lawyers get done, when the deed gets done.
I'm here.
There's Jen. So you work with Jen too.
And there will be other discussions that you'll have that kind of fell through the cracks on that other piece of property that you had that we don't want to have happen again.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Could we file it?
Yes.
In the newspaper accordingly?
Yep. Yep. Yes.
Yep. Twice.
So
that's why. Yeah.
But it's I think part of that was our fault, but I mean it was we just don't want this to happen again. Because we're very excited about this.
Yeah.
Yep.
I was the guy out there building it in the middle of the winter going.
We could have done this earlier.
Thank
great.
You.
Well,
okay.
Welcome to Deerfield.
All right.
And,
thank you.
Really looking
yeah.
forward to working with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Well,
yeah.
Whatever works for you, we'll nominate your schedule.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Be a good win for Deerfield for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That's pretty exciting.
You want to talk to Paul while he's here?
Oh, please. Yeah,
okay.
For sure. I was hoping you'd be here tonight.
Yeah, please. Come on
minute.
Up. Yeah. We'll skip around the agenda.
Yeah, nobody can hear you unless you're at the mic, Paul.
No. If Paul starts talking, you're going to hear him from the
No, room. You'll hear him. You could hear him.
I know.
So I'm here. John has approached all of you guys. I've worked with him. So you tell me.
I was curious to find out, are they still interested down there at the college?
I talked to the director of music, Hugh Hinton, a couple weeks ago.
Yep.
And with COVID, it appears that the project now to start the renovations in the chapel, you know, in the church,
yep.
on the campus, it's started. It's sort of dumbed down a little bit, scaled back with the pandemic. But what appears is going to happen is they're going to build out, and the hope is by maybe late spring, they'll have a lot of it done. They're going to go, wasn't there supposed to be an organ there?
Yeah.
It's going to sort of force the thing because, right. I mean, there's a significant cost here for them to take the organ apart and then, you know, and then put it back, you know, together again.
Right.
And which I've been working with, the gentleman down east on that.
Yep.
And so it looks like they've got that. I mean, okay. It has legs, and yep. I'm going to stay in contact with them. And the hope is that when it gets to that point, they're going to say, hey, I guess we need to do something about the organ because they're just going to continue with what they have. And
can
the
I
goal
interrupt
is really
you for one sec?
Yes.
I didn't catch your name. Just
First name Paul, last name Olszewski.
Olszewski.
Paul Olszewski.
So with that said, also working with Matt from the organ company down east, and also with Hugh, they suggested that, you know, in case plan B, if something didn't bear fruition, a gentleman by the name of John Bishop, and I know John.
That's what John.
The organ clearinghouse.
Yeah.
I vetted him out. You go to their website. It's quite extensive what they do. They find homes for organs.
Great.
The sad thing about it is the gentleman from the organ company and also John says, with a number of churches that are unfortunately going by the wayside, a lot of these organs turn into firewood.
That's what you'd
mention. Or some people are sort of creative. They turn it into, they let a carpenter come in and break wood, you know, they break it down.
Yeah.
And then they build other things with it, which is sort of an afterlife kind of thing. But the hope is because this one, both Hugh and the gentleman from the organ company played it and they like it.
Yeah.
The organ is made out of Westfield, but it's been featured in competitions and shows as recently as, I want to say 2015, I believe it was. But it's got legs and but in terms of, because there's so many churches that have gone by the wayside, the value of these things is they're a dime a dozen.
That's what you were saying earlier, I think.
And the other problem is the organ company that, you know, I've been working with, and like I say, we went, probably spent a day going through it, visited it three times, been inside. The best thing for that organ right now is to stay, it's sort of in a cryogenic state. It hasn't had the big swings of heat, humidity.
Right.
So the bellows and everything are actually, you know, in great shape for being shut down for this long. The 30 pipe organ. So like I say, he says the best thing is if you open up a little bit, but it just really needs to, until something is decided, stay where she is.
Yeah.
And
Paul, can I just interrupt you for a minute to follow up on that? Because at our 350th anniversary committee meeting, Jay Stryker wanted to know if he could get permission, and I was going to bring it up at the select board, to play the organ. He's a mechanical genius as well as a musician. So, but I just wanted to follow up with you on this. Does when you were saying it was good for the organ,
it was actually good
not,
for how it's been stable.
So not to play it?
I'll be honest with you, Carolyn, I wouldn't. I really, you know, both John Bishop and this gentleman from the organ company, when they're like this and they, you know, they haven't been used for some time until you decide what you're going to do, you know, either you know, you stay or you go. It's good to exercise like anything, but it really, the way it's been sitting, it'd be good just to sort of let a sleeping dog lie. It's been a suspended.
Just
keep it that way. That's the recommendation from two professionals.
All right. Then I'll follow up with Jay.
Yeah. John Bishop has a crew and he's out of Maine, but if you saw the website, the pictures, I mean, they go around and some of the organs that they've removed and they're restoring, it's quite something.
Yeah.
He would be willing to, I don't say advertise. He has his own social media. I'm not talking Facebook or, you know, all the other platforms, but he has sources throughout the country, Northeast, that he could find a home. And I think it would be best if this thing was placed with a nonprofit, a church, which Merrimack College is a church. And it would be great to have it. And Hugh, the gentleman, the music director there, played it. And I stood back in January 2020, and she sounds good.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
She does. I mean, I was, you know, part of the church, was trustee, treasurer, and so we did put money into repairing and keeping it up. And it's a very unique group of people that can take care of this thing.
Right.
And I was lucky through Hugh to get a hold of the gentleman in Andover that's all they do. The other problem, and not to digress here, is getting back to when you have so many of these organs, they used to have warehouse space, they would break down an organ and literally sort of put it like a Lego set and put it away. And then if they had somebody, you know, yank it out and install it.
Yeah.
But now the cost of warehousing is just astronomical, the cost of doing business, so they don't do that anymore. So what John Bishop comes in and does, he can provide, I've got something sitting there, let's see if we can move it.
Right.
It would take about, according to Matt, it would take about a week to break it down, you know, because they would build the cases, and basically it would go out the front door.
Okay.
Because really the thing, she'll break down pretty, it sort of, you know, a lot of it comes apart.
Okay.
So it's not a case of not coming apart. It would just be, you know, physical labor getting it out the door and then shipping it down. So I'm going to stay on Merrimack, you know, Merrimack's case with Hugh.
Yep.
But John Bishop would be glad to, and it's not a money-making thing. He just doesn't like to see these things go disappear.
Yeah.
Because some of them, he said, some of them have been, they're just worn out. They're tired. This one has been taken care of. It's not tired. And it would be nice to have it placed somewhere else. Or, you know what I mean? What John would like to see from the town, and this is what I've been sort of been belaboring, and I appreciate John getting involved, and I know Rick Andreoli wanted to be here. Just some kind of letter from the town saying it's okay for you to not act as an agent. I don't want to get into law here, but for him to advertise, hey, town of Deerfield has this organ. It's in inventory. You can, you know, who to contact, how to negotiate to get the legality. Because like he says, they're essentially a dime a dozen.
Yeah.
And a number of them have already gone to scrap and firewood. And, I mean, congregational churches, and it's not just congregational churches. I mean, Catholic churches, all these organs. You think in the valley here.
I can imagine. That,
where have these organs gone? I mean, some of them are
just like beautiful. Someone's living room.
Right.
You know.
So it's a case of, you know, let's do what's right for this thing.
I agree.
And, you know, if we can find a home, but I think we'd like to keep it, and I agree with John, I agree with Rick, that let's keep it with like a nonprofit or a church and find a good home. And the good thing about John Bishop is, and I've talked to him several times, he finds homes.
Right.
You know, it's not like he just puts it on eBay, you know, it's like an eBay guy, you know,
where it needs
guy comes up and says, hey, I'll give you, you know, here's a check and, you know, tell me where to pick it up. He finds the organs, and I think his website sort of demonstrates that, the meticulous pains they go through. So if we could, you know, like I say, for myself as a member and Laurie and a few others that were members of the church and the like, if we could get it in, the, you know, have it designated surplus, and then, like I say, if you could provide me with some form of letter I could pass on to John and just say, hey, go ahead and talk about it.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you find a person, you know, I would stay in the loop and bring it to the town and vet them out. But like I say, I'm trying to get Merrimack to, I'm hoping Hugh says, based on the construction, that if they get to the point and they go, oh, I guess we need an organ after all. You know, that's the plan. I mean, they sort of had to curtail with, let's face it, during COVID, you know, your revenues went
way down.
And, you know, private colleges, I mean, you know, they tend to have more, you know, deeper pockets, but still they have their limitations. So this is where we're at. I just don't want to see this, the old girl, you know, going into the scrap pile.
Yeah.
Whatever you need to compose.
Yeah. Do we need to
declare? Would the office see it?
And do we have a form to do that? Or
no,
we
just take a vote.
Okay. So we'll take Is there German issues that go along with this? Not getting money for it. We're just declaring.
Well, but it does have a value. Requirements in the law about value.
Yeah, but
so,
can we just declare it surplus property and accept like a dollar?
Well, I think what we need to know, to your point, Paul, is where an avenue to dispose of it would be. First, it has to be it has to be voted as surplus property for disposal.
So we can do that.
You need a motion to do that.
I make a motion that we declare it surplus. After this discussion, I think we all agree that we need.
Do you have a hand up? Do you want to take any more comments?
Motion on the floor right now.
Yes.
I'm making a motion
to declare it surplus because I think there is, after this discussion, that we do want to see it go to a good home.
I'll second that motion for discussion.
Okay. Greg?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I'm just wanting to ask. First, I want to express my appreciation for all the effort that you've put into trying to make sure that the organ has a good home. But before you vote, I was wondering if you could talk just a little bit about the other options besides churches. You said nonprofits or churches or universities.
Well, I mean, we're trying to get it to a home that, you know, it's just not selling it to, I don't know, you know,
a nonprofit, I think is what.
Yeah, I mean, we're not here to make money. You know, it's not a money making thing. You just want to make sure it has a good home. You know,
you said nonprofits. I was just wondering what types of nonprofits want pipe.
Oh, I don't know. Well, of course, the college.
It is.
I mean, they make a buck, but yeah.
They do, but they're considered a Roman Catholic nonprofit.
Right.
I think we're agreeing to put it someplace where it will actually be used.
Right.
And not repurposed or.
I mean, Merrimack's not going to make if that's where hopefully it could go. They're not making money on. You know what
right,
I mean?
No,
it's not a revenue generator.
But they would also use it.
They would use it every day, week. You know, with as
what
part
are your
of the,
thoughts on that, Greg?
Well,
why did you ask the question?
I asked the question because earlier in the discussion, you mentioned that Jay Stryker wanted to give the community a performance and. I know that they have performances regularly in Old Deerfield, and I know that there's been discussion of the church being reused as a community center / senior center, and I'm just wondering whether this decision has to be made before the decision is made about whether we're going to have a community center there, because I don't know whether any of you have ever played a pipe organ, but I had the good fortune at one point in my life to have that experience, and it's a phenomenal instrument, and it's unlike anything else I've ever experienced, and I think it's an amazing thing that this town has a pipe organ that could be, you know, in its community center. I don't know I mean, who knows whether the church is going to become a community center? Maybe it's going to get torn down. But if the church does become a community center, it seems like this vote is maybe premature because we already have a resident who's asked if he could give a performance. So obviously, there are people in our community that know how to play these or know how to play a pipe organ. And there's a lot of music that was written that isn't religious in nature for the pipe organ. And it's great music. So I just was wondering whether it might be an option to delay the vote until we know whether the building is going to become a community center or not.
I have no strong feeling either way. I think if there is a home for it and the church wants it, great. But my guess is it's going to sit a while as we
right.
go through this.
And like I say, the more we can push this, you know, not, I don't say kick the can
yeah.
down the road, if we can at least have options.
Right.
I mean, that's all well and good. But if the church has decided, you know, that it, you know,
it goes, down or not,
you know,
down.
It goes.
Yeah.
I've got, you know, I have a lifeboat here.
Right.
You know, and some measurements have been taken. It will fit based on the plans at Merrimack. That's right. Solid. Mm-hmm. That's exactly, you know, it will fit their plans. Like I said, John Bishop, can also have, I mean, you can talk about this and it's probably going to take a little bit, you know, like I say, hopefully by early spring, I should know more with Merrimack.
Right.
Right. Because there will be a cash outlay of their expense
to remove
and install.
Yeah.
I mean,
right. And also we'll have some decisions based on we just voted that to Connecting Communities Initiative for the umbrella committee to have a vision of what we're doing.
But would it hurt to put it as surplus, and that way you have that? I mean, at least you have that. I mean, one thing is fine.
You know, we'll take it back out.
Well, when you declare it surplus, you have an intent to dispose of it.
And if we choose not to?
Don't have to dispose of it.
There we go.
But the, in order to move forward with anything that Paul's describing, is it has to be declared surplus property.
Well, at least you could be able to do that.
At least you have an option to do that, yes.
Well, why don't we move ahead, declare it, you know, surplus property, so that Paul, who's already put in so much work, can move this forward, and then we'll find out what we're doing.
Right.
But everything is moving.
And it, like I say, if I could have something, that way John Bishop can get it out there. Maybe there, you know, because, I mean, it's very specific. I mean,
right.
I spent a half a day with Matt measuring.
Right.
And then we measured up, down, sideways. Yeah,
yeah.
It'll fit Merrimack.
Right.
Yeah, he took it, he figured out how much, you know, because obviously it came in one way through
right.
the church, so it's going to probably go back out the
yeah.
same way it came in.
Yeah.
So that's covered. So we have those things in place. So, you know, if you want to entertain that, but at the same time, I think if that doesn't bear, like you're saying,
well,
if it doesn't become a community center, then at least now you've...
Right, but I feel like it's
the
too
money
parallel
that we're
thing.
Talking about right now don't include the main church.
Right. Oh, no, I know that. But if,
so
but let's say, you know, oh, no, I know the sanctuary. No,
yeah.
I understand that. I would just... And I would ask.
I grew up in that church.
And I did. My parents were married there in 55, and I was married there. And your family was. So, you know, we have a lot invested. The one thing I would ask, with, if you can during this time, try to keep her quiet. You know, no heat. You know,
right.
Big swings.
Yep.
That's what's been keeping, because you know. The pipes, the wooden pipes, the metal pipes, all of that, they don't need, much like your house, big temperature swings.
Yeah, right.
I think we would maintain the minimal temperature like we did.
And it likes it, believe it or not, you know, the cold, but there's no humidity, it's dry.
Mm,
you know what
right.
I'm saying? So
right.
it doesn't mind that.
Yeah.
Sean, got a question.
What year was that organ put in there?
Squirrels out there, too.
Oh, yeah.
We have a pipe organ at my church in Greenfield, and we can't use it because the squirrels have eaten all the leather away in there.
Oh.
And that's, yeah, and that's what I've watched.
We can't even play it. We have to get restored, and we'll have the money for that.
Yeah.
So,
what year was that put in, you know?
What's that?
You know, what year?
1907.
07?
There's a plaque on there. It was a gift. The name escapes me. I have the pictures. But yeah, 1907, and it was made down a gentleman that built it started his craft. And I'll be brief. He worked a lot of these guys, much like clockmakers and everything. He started out in Boston, and they got good at this stuff. And then they said, oh, I can build organs too. And then they developed their own companies. And this gentleman was out of Westfield, but at 1907, so it was built right at the turn of the century.
Yeah. I know growing up, I was told Dr. Rice had done a lot to...
He might have, but there is a plaque right over the, it's, you know, right up, right in front on
right,
top of the keyboard.
Right the keyboard.
Yeah. But,
okay.
Yeah, it's like I say, and if you could get back to me with something that I can pass along, John, he can at least, because like I say, there might not be takers. There
right.
could be. I'll
yeah.
keep working the Merrimack group, and because that, they already resigned themselves, you know, Matthew's already told them what, you know, in terms of breaking down
yeah.
and then putting the whole thing
well,
together again.
I know Jay could play for himself, but he wouldn't be able to play for the community, Greg, until we have the accessibility fixed at the, you know, church. So
right.
that area is
yeah, it needs an occupancy
occupied.
Permit,
yeah.
which has no permit at the moment. So,
right.
I will call Jay and let him know
yeah.
that
it really should just let her
sit. And that we're going to determine what's happening in the next few months.
Well, like I say, at least we have some options, you know, because, you know, you get to a point and you go, well, that's not working. What do we have?
Right.
So at least you got a few things on the table.
Yeah.
All right. So if you could let me know, like, and I can, I won't say anything until I hear from you, to John Bishop.
Okay.
You know.
Did you second?
I seconded your motion.
Okay.
Okay.
Any further discussion? Jennifer, you had your hand up earlier? No? Okay.
Nope, was waving at Alex.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
All right, well, I appreciate it.
Okay.
Oh, you got to vote.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of declaring a surplus?
Aye, Carolyn.
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
Okay.
Thank you. Where that goes.
And we'll get a letter to you.
Yeah.
Casey will
Let me know.
Work out something.
Something.
Like, you need a disposition vote?
Excuse me?
Would it be helpful if I sent you the disposition vote?
Yeah, and he just, he knows that he can freely say, hey, I know in Deerfield there's an organ. You know, he just doesn't want to be an agent.
Then find out you can't.
Without proper authority, so.
Right.
It's just everyone covering themselves, so.
Sure.
Same email?
Okay.
That you always said?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Have a good evening.
Thank you, Paul, for doing all that work.
Well, as I say, hopefully we'll find a good place.
Yeah.
Well, it's very nice.
I just didn't, you know, if everything else, if something hasn't come down, at least that. All right, thank you.
While we're still talking about the church, can I just bring up the repairs to the steeple? Just, you know, that board that...
The board is missing. The door.
Door. Can we get that done next?
Do we know anybody who can make that?
No.
Yes.
I'm out.
Sorry.
I'm out. What?
You go first, Jennifer.
You were timing out.
I was timing out because I wanted to tell them. Peter Thomas came in and talked to me.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Describe what needs to be happened.
Yeah,
he sent it to me.
We need to talk to Kevin.
And we need to figure out how to do that, because if we don't, we just need to work through what needs to happen. And Kevin's on vacation. So it makes sense that we do some coordination internally. Because there's also a price.
You have that sketch.
He sent me the entire thing.
Yep.
So
okay.
The reason I said timeout is there's stuff that needs to happen inside, like with other departments, so we can coordinate it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's what I told Peter.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure that we were trying to get that done, because that actually
closes.
We need to close it up so the town clock is not drowned.
Right.
I mean, the water's getting in and you can't.
Yeah.
No, we have. You'll be able to build it. He's talked to Peter Thomas. Has talked to. Give me help, Casey. What's his?
I don't
Carpenter?
Remember. No. Somebody.
Volunteer.
Another
volunteer.
Was it Jay Stryker? It must be Jay.
Yes. So it's Jay. Yeah, Jay Stryker has his own. Wood
shop. Like me. And I'm not making a door.
It looks like a Da Vinci Code. Yes.
Yeah.
He's going to end up.
Well, I know a couple of carpenters. I was going to volunteer to do it. So.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They're probably happy that I didn't.
Right.
Especially now that it's coming to hunting season.
Oh, yeah. Stoss should not be.
Thank you.
Enough.
I couldn't remember the name, Jennifer.
Sorry. Yeah, it was Jay. He has his own wood shop. And so when I was talking to him, I said, oh, there's somebody on the 350th that I know has his own wood shop, because he teaches kids at, anyway, so he got together with Jay and talked to him, and they're going to build it. We just have to get him the supplies and obviously then talk to Kevin about how to replace it, so.
Okay.
Perfect.
Okay.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. I was just really worried about that hole in the steeple.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Alex is on, okay. So do you want to jump there, David?
Yeah.
Yep, the fees, yep.
Hi, Alex.
Hi, Alex. Thank you for coming.
Hi. Thank you for letting me come.
I saw your list of the fees, and...
I just shared it, if it's on the big screen.
Okay.
Yep.
So the ones in yellow were changed?
Oh, wait. Do I have the old one? Sorry.
Yeah, I think that's the old one, Jen.
Oh, sigh.
That's okay.
Do
you
have
the
new
one to share?
Oh, I think I have the old one.
You have the new one. I printed on your, in your box. Do you have it?
So, Alex, could you talk to us about why the change? Have you, were you evaluating other towns kind of where we are? I know we probably haven't changed these for a while. Talk to me a little bit about that.
Oh, okay.
You got it right. Okay. Yep, you got it. It just a little, you know, I think the last time we had the fee change was in 2012. Is that right?
Probably before my time, yeah. For sure.
So we just, most of the fees were just increased by $50 just to meet the capacity for covering the inspectional cost. So there really not much there.
No, it looks good.
It looks good. Thank you, Alex. I appreciate you updating everything.
Me too. Yeah, very great.
You're welcome. It's my job.
Yeah. We appreciate you doing it.
I would make a motion that we approve the Board of Health fees as presented by Alex.
I'll second that motion, Trevor.
Okay. Point of discussion. Should we talk about the food trucks? I got you to smile anyways, that Alex.
Is that a question for me? Oh, sure. Yeah. What's up?
Well, it says to be determined.
To intervene for poor Alex, we were trying to figure out a way that is fair, but not to give up our ability to inspect on a regular basis. So I don't know, Alex, what did your research turn up as what you came across?
I know that in Deerfield we have the use of temporary food events for anything when it comes to food trucks at the moment, following, you know, it's $25 a day for an event up to 4 days, so equivalent to that of $100. And then anything after that, you need a new temporary food event when it comes to food trucks. And we do that solely because of the fact that we need to inspect the food trucks. And the annual permit is a little bit of a different approach than what the Deerfield Board of Health feels is appropriate right now. So that's why I put to be determined, because we are in discussion with that. I know that the temporary food event application is going fairly well in that regard. So whatever discussion that we have on that, I'm very much open to.
So for a food service, we charge $150 a year, right? Once, and then we inspect however much we want, but typically once a year.
No, twice a year.
Twice a year. So then
twice a year.
What I just want to make sure is that we're not overcharging food trucks. You know, it's hard to make a profit anyways in this business, but you want to have that oversight, because it's a lot harder to keep a food truck clean, right, and serve
safe
than it is to a regular restaurant. We've got indoor plumbing, bathrooms and cleaning and all that stuff. A truck's a lot harder to do. It's also a lot harder to make a profit, but you don't have the overhead that you would, you know, at a restaurant. It's just trying to find that happy medium of, and then covering the cost of our inspector to go out, you know, multiple times to be constantly going out there, then we end up losing our shirt for doing this. So it is a fine balance, I think, that needs to happen.
Most of our, over the years, from a food serve safe point of view, most of our issues have been food trucks versus
permanent
restaurants.
Right.
And mm-hmm. so that's why we've always in the past done at least one inspection if they have a multiple run. But you can kind of tell, and Alex can verify this, you can kind of tell if the person is borderline or whatever, or they run a really...
They're all about safety.
Safety,
right.
Cleanliness, and everything is organized really well.
Yeah.
So it's similar to a restaurant. If we notice violations, we feel compelled to go out, you know, every day that the person is there. So it can cost us as a group money. Obviously, if myself or Dick were doing it on the weekends, Dick is, you know, he's not putting in for his weekend time, and, you know, I don't get any money for it. So over the years, we've had, you know, you kind of know who it is and who's, and like the craft show that they have, the craft fair at Old Deerfield that PVMA runs, you know, they have pretty high quality food trucks. We had a couple problems, but then they don't get invited back. It's very hard. Yeah, I mean, you had pretty good experience, right?
Yeah, and I'll just add that when it comes to food trucks, the temporary food event seems like, just from the context and the history in Deerfield, food trucks are not coming in on a regular basis in Deerfield. So I believe that's why we have the temporary food event. But if we were to do the annual permits for food trucks, we would have to sort of revamp that and do a pre-operational inspection. And so the temporary food event is doing a pre-operational inspection and also a routine inspection as well. So we will, you know, try to make that determination later down the road, what to do next in that regard. That's why I put to be determined.
Because I think the landscape of Deerfield's changing with Treehouse and BBC.
Well, that was why, you know, and because of COVID,
yeah.
you know, with Berkshire Brew, they were using food trucks, and Treehouse clearly is going to use
yeah.
food trucks. So, and that does seem to be the future of what we're trying to do. So we
right.
need to figure out some kind of way.
Fair inspection, but a way
yeah,
to inspect.
Right. And so... The only thing I can say is we should keep working on it.
Okay.
And part of it really is determining who's going to show up at Treehouse.
Yeah.
mean, do they have a regular cycle of the same
right.
food
truck? Right, they get the same people every time.
Or you know, I mean, it's going to be, can we have a relationship with these food trucks? Because we have a relationship with our restaurants.
Right.
We have a relationship with who is operating.
Right.
And so if the food trucks become not a temporary kind of, you know, once a year.
Then we have more of a relationship.
We have more of a relationship. I think we would feel more comfortable doing more, you know.
Longer scale.
Yeah. I mean, we can just back off a little.
Right.
Because we know that, you know, the quality.
There.
But it really, if from a risk perspective, in my mind, the risk perspective, the food truck is probably the most risky operation for
yeah.
food safety.
Yeah.
And that's why we, you know, we kind of want to keep an eye on it for now.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Well, gotta love cruises.
Yeah.
David.
Jennifer?
Casey, did you want to say something before I said something? Your hand
No,
was...
I was actually going to make sure that you got a chance to speak.
Oh, thank you. Well, Dick and Casey and myself and who else was there? I know this was before Alex's time, but we had sat down and we had discussed about a different like fee schedule when it came to these food trucks, in the sense of and who has the serves, you know, who has the serve safe and who's going to be making sure that the food trucks, so the onus isn't totally on our Board of Health members, but also the business like Treehouse. Do you remember that conversation, Casey?
I do.
Yeah, and just, I think that that's also something to take into consideration because we were talking, did Dick, Alex talk to you at all about what we had, talked about as far as fees?
No, not that. We just talked about the different processes that will most likely happen in order to ensure of the safety of food protection in Deerfield.
Yeah. I know it was really important. And so maybe I'll look back and see what notes that I kept from that meeting and also just talk to Dick about it and see what he recalls, because it seemed that there was a general consensus of fees and the amount of the time that the Board of Health would need to spend in their inspections. And it was many, many months ago. So just so it's like a realistic amount for the number of inspections that need to be done.
I think if there is a true rotation, like at Treehouse, if they have, say Joe hot dogs or whatever comes every 3 months or something like that, then, we'll have an idea.
We know who they are.
Yeah, we know who they are and what kind of inspection we had with them. And then who, we'll know who holds the ServSafe certificate and it will already be on in our records and stuff. So, I think it really comes down to what kind of relationship we're going to have and how random these food trucks are, and I have to say I think they probably are going to have the same kind of some kind of rotation of regular vendors. I just can't believe that they would have so many choice, that it would, they have to have vetted them. And when you went down, Jen, you went down, did you go down to Treehouse?
No,
did
I you, did
oh do you did Did,
oh,
did
you mean to Charlton?
Treehouse.
Yeah. They must have had, did you find out how many vendors they had on a regular basis, food trucks? Were the same people, once a month, every couple
of
weeks?
It really depended, is what they told us. They said that it really just depended on the availability, and so the rotation, it wasn't something that was regular. So that's where we run into the problem, is something leaving the site and coming back on site without inspection. That's why when we were discussing this before, that the onus goes on to the person who has the ServSafe too, as well as us doing spontaneous inspections of the whatever food cart is there. And we'll have these permits for everybody. Everybody will have to have a permit with us to have a food truck. However, it's on Treehouse or whoever has that permit to have the regular to be able to make sure that they're meeting the standards, because Alex or Dick or whoever our Board of Health agent that's checking is going to be making stops on a regular basis and making sure that they're to the standard that has to be met. I know it's super important, to you, Carolyn, for sure, for everybody's health and Board of Health, but we were just trying to troubleshoot how do you hire somebody if they have a different truck there every week? Several different.
That's the challenge. That's why we're having this conversation, and Alex and I have had it. So I think when we started talking about the permit fees themselves, we started talking about having a meeting. So I think maybe we should do that.
Yeah,
but whatever it is, I think, however it goes, there's some lessons to be learned from some of the towns around us.
Yeah.
Because there's a couple breweries down in East Hampton that do this on a regular basis, and their experience might be helpful. So it may be worthwhile for Alex to reach out. And he knows that we had talked about East Hampton before. He knows about those. So, but from Carolyn's perspective, until we see it in action, we really don't have a flavor for what it's going to look like.
I know, that's why the temporary food event kind of works at the moment, and
Alex is going to have to sort of, Alex and Dick, and probably you, because I know you do some of those inspections as well, we'll just have to sort of suss through what the process needs to evolve to, like Jennifer said, because there's some sort of evolution that's going to happen here. We just don't know what it's going to look like yet.
I know. I just,
and I'll tell you, it begins with a pre-operational inspection. Absolutely.
Right.
That's number one. Having a checklist and an assessment just to make sure that everyone's on the same page when they come to Deerfield, and, you know, knowing that there is the food code, and, you know, having that responsibility, but just saying that these are the most critical items when it comes to the inspection that needs to be in compliance. And then also just mentioning, you know, just building that kind of rapport and understanding what that business is providing and the kind of food. So the level of food risk based on the menu, making sure that the fire department or, you know, the ANSEL system is also in compliance and other components as well. So it's going to be a working and document and process. So it's going to be good. It's going to be good.
Okay. So we approved all these. Did we had a second. I don't know if we voted.
We haven't taken the vote. Any further discussion?
Nope.
All those in favor of the new?
Aye, three. Carolyn.
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
Alex, thanks, Alex, thank you so much. Are you in Boston right now?
I'm in Boston.
Well, thank you for taking time from your schedule to join us tonight.
Not a problem. Not a problem. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that was a little bit late, but I'm glad that
you showed up right on time.
You were perfect.
Awesome. Thank you. Bye, guys.
Bye, Alex.
So, now that we've skipped all over the place here, Selectman reports announcements.
Well, I do want to say that on September 26th, the 350 Friends of Deerfield for the 350th had another wonderful, successful painting, landscape painting. It was the Punkin Patch in Deerfield, and it was really fun, and it was really well attended as before, and they did a great job. Stan Adams did a wonderful food snack again. I know, it's beautiful, and I actually won the centerpiece.
Did you?
Yes.
Very nice.
Yeah, and he did a beautiful centerpiece.
Right?
He did a gorgeous centerpiece. So, anyway, it was very successful. So I just wanted to say, anybody that's interested in the 350th, we're doing the gala for sure. We're doing the parade, the fireworks, the 5K. There's already a few events that are already decided on. And if anyone's interested, please come forward. It's starting to come together.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you for the work on that. It's a lot of work.
It's really, it's exciting.
Jump in on that at some point here.
Don't worry, we're going to pull you in.
I'll be there.
Both of you?
Oh, yeah. You're
not going to have a beer fest at this one.
Yes. There'll be Berkshire Brewers.
A $5 mug and you could drink all night.
I don't know if it's going to be $5 anymore, but Berkshire Brew is going to brew a 350th.
Nice.
Deerfield 350th
good
brew.
Good.
It's a unique brew. So I'm really excited about that.
Yeah. So I've got, we had several meetings last week. We had a meeting at the wastewater treatment plant for an update, our monthly meeting. Everything's going very well there. They're moving along really good. They're focusing on the headwork building. You'll see a lot of the concrete's done. They'll be setting block, I think, in a couple weeks. And then they're starting on the pump station, the pump building. So all that seems to be going really, really well, moving along. Then we settled back here for a meeting with Casey, Brenda, Barb to talk about, budget next year, our rates we have to set pretty quick here. We have a hearing posted on that, but we had started to look at what's coming next. So we've started to evaluate what to do with the other plant and or to pump it to South Deerfield. Those are those kind of things we started to talk about. And we started talking about phase two and getting an application before USDA, because Dave's been in touch with USDA about when their best time to drop in to get the best deal. And that's coming up pretty quick. So I think that I think through the next few months, they'll be starting on design, you know, getting a budget together to start on design. So they're going to bring back to us, if I have this right, Casey,
yep,
a proposal to kind of, so we'd have a number for capital, how much we need to set aside for design work to get phase two going.
Right.
And what's included in phase two?
Phase two is like the aeration tanks, you know, getting rid of those electricity sucking fans on the top and doing more of the bubble up from below.
Right.
There's some things that we were hoping to get done in phase two. We're just not going to be able to because of the money. You know, we voted $19 million. This first phase was a lot more than that, but we can pull in. We pulled in some things from phase two to phase one. That's why it's more money.
Right.
But also the bids, you know, are a lot more right now. So he's going to still stick with that $19 million. We should be able to get done most everything we can, but have these, the way he's going to structure phase two is in alternates, so that we can go after like a MVP grant or go after,
okay,
any, so they'll all be separated out. So if we have infrastructure stuff that we can go after, this, the governor wants to spend, I think, $500 million on wastewater and water treatment over the next few years. So anything we can pull out.
I was just going to say, if the infrastructure bill goes through, you know, Congress, can,
yeah,
would we be ready?
Yeah,
I just
we'll be
want to make,
that's the idea. So we're going to be ready for this. We're looking at,
okay,
other stuff. We've
other
got pipe right work that we've got figured out. So we have some numbers on pipe work for South Deerfield, pipe work for Old Deerfield. But
do you have the pipe work for Pine Nook?
Yes, we have that as well.
Separate,
and then
that's
separate. That's
okay,
separate. And also, Dave is working with Kevin on the engineering part of the road, kind of,
okay,
get that figured out. So there'll be all these separate items that we,
okay,
can, if we see something, we can go grab it. But I think it's worth investing in the engineering up front.
Absolutely.
So we're shovel ready.
Absolutely.
We know
need
we
to
have
shovel
to do
it,
them. But
there's,
grab them when we can grab them and go.
There's money, there's going to be money, and there is money. And so what we have to do is now we have to go market this. This is why this is so important,
yep,
that we go to Boston.
Yes.
And we have to figure out who we channel this through,
yep,
to make sure we're on that list.
Exactly.
For the state. And then we have to pay attention. You know, we got to get in touch with, I think we need to talk to McGovern's office, but then reach out,
mm-hmm,
to Richie Neal's office.
Yes.
And say, or ask McGovern to reach out to Richie Neal's. This is what we've got to do. We've got to,
yeah,
follow up on that.
Absolutely. And the other, you know, the other thing is we're, you know, at the FERCOG meeting coming up, I was discussing with Linda Dunleavy about, you know, what topics we're going to be talking about. And Suzanne Bumps, you know, the audit just came out.
Yeah. I had Jennifer printed me out the hard copy.
Perfect.
We did a very good job on selling, you know, our infrastructure's falling apart.
Yep.
So what do we do with that? And
right.
I think we need to leverage that.
That's what's going to be the topic of our next FERCOG council meeting. So if you want to come to that.
Well,
that, and then how do we bring it to the town? And how do we advocate? I don't have the date off the top of my head, but I'm sure I can get it for you.
Because I was going to ask that, you know, Jonathan, we got to get beat up on Jonathan. We got to schedule a selectman's meeting.
Yes, I'd like to do that too.
They have some concerns too. They would like to meet.
Yeah.
I think they, Jonathan.
I know. Yeah, we talked.
You guys
about
need
that
to have that meeting.
Yep.
Well, we were. No, I'm talking about
the
Frank.
I know the selectman.
I mean,
yeah,
the association,
yeah,
meeting.
Yeah.
Yep.
I know. We should be doing something with all four counties, but even our county, we've got to get together.
Yep.
Because Marguerite Willis has been, you know, I know she's been bugging me. I know she's been bugging you.
Yep.
She's, because you have the police reform stuff that we're paying for, and we have all this infrastructure stuff that we got to sort out, and you know, the task force for the mosquito stuff is not, they never really came up with any recommendations.
The MAPCO after action plan is next Monday, right?
Yes, you signed up. Thank you.
I did. Yep. So there's a lot happening, and I think a lot of people don't recognize, but there is just a bunch going on, and it's like herding cats trying to figure all this stuff out and get it.
We have a lot of.
This was six, this is my sixth meeting.
It's not just wastewater, it's building.
I know.
I'm just.
Many things that need to be coordinated, and so that's policy decisions on the board's part.
There's so much happening, and there's so many balls in the, but what is bothering me is there is so many balls in the air right now with all this money floating around, but nobody's committing the money.
Right.
So you're just like meeting after meeting after meeting, and everybody's getting ready, but nobody's.
Nobody knows exactly what door to open.
Right.
Okay, we're ready. We need it.
So I don't know how, we've got to be smart about this, and we've got to be aware, but.
You're going to Boston, right?
You all are going, you're all scheduled to go.
Yeah, great.
Well, and we got to still follow up on that waiver for the school foundation budget. You know, the waiver we got for 01342. And then she's supposed to be breaking out Whately from our 01373 zip code. And,
Well, we'll keep on that. We'll check down in Boston again and keep on. But so anyways, we had this meeting just to kind of go, okay, these are large projects coming up for the town. How do we want to handle them? But it was really just to kind of talk about rates and capital for next year, at least to get phase two going. So we just kind of keep rolling with it. I don't want to see, I would love to see Waterline win that second bid because they're awesome and they're there. And that's going to be a mobilization saving. So if they're there already and they know they can go move into the next, their bid's going to be less than anybody that's got to come and set up.
Right. Well, the good thing is they're good contractors.
They're great.
I know.
They are great.
I mean, we've had experience with bad contractors lately.
They've
cost us a lot of money. Yeah.
So that's, you know, that's it.
Okay.
Could I make a suggestion, please?
Mm-hmm.
Poor Lori's been sitting there waiting about the EV charger.
Oh, my God. Oh, Lori, honestly, I'm sorry.
So it's the EV charging system user rate.
Oh, I thought.
She had a suggestion. Right, Lori?
I understand that a little bit, too.
Oh, okay. Let's jump around to that.
I know it's a jump around night.
No, that's all right. Lori, I'm so sorry.
Working up a sweat. Good thing.
Hi, do I hear my name?
Hey, listen, I'm really sorry. I thought you were just being there for interest. I did not know that you were going to be talking to us about the EV charging station.
Let's see. Okay. So I can just tell you what my thoughts are after, you know, Casey and I talked with Tim Simmons at Eversource. She and I have both talked to different towns, Montague, Amherst. I guess Casey talked to Northfield. So I guess the bottom line is that electric vehicles are not going to be less expensive as long as gas is artificially low because our government subsidizes the oil and gas companies. So I don't think we need to think about it as competing with the gasoline prices. I think what we're offering in the town is a service for a car that's, you know, purely electric vehicles. So I think we should definitely set a price that's going to cover our costs. And Tim Simmons' thought on that was on the higher end was 70 cents per kilowatt hour. So I guess it seems I'm leaning towards going with the expert opinion. So that's my two cents on that. And the only other thought that I said to Casey is that, you know, we could make it 75 cents to make sure that we cover the 10% fee going to charge point. And then I liked Casey's idea of starting a revolving fund so that we have an account for the Greenfield Savings Bank money to go into and, you know, a way to kind of balance out when we collect more money 1 month and less money another month, that kind of thing. But also to know that, you know, if we find out after a month that, you know, we're not collecting enough, then we could change the rate pretty easily. So the person, there's a person on the charge point account that you can call up. This is what Gus Moore, Guilford Mooring told me in Amherst, and he'll, you just tell him what you want to set it at and he'll change it, you know, instantaneously for you. So I think it's going to be a little bit of a trial and error, but I don't feel like we should worry about if it's too expensive for people. It's really a convenience. So in the early days, you know, people were encouraging the use of EVs and so on.
Oh, I think you froze, Roy.
Anymore,
oh, so. There you go. We missed part of that, Lori.
Sorry, we missed it.
Oh,
we missed part of what
you missed
said.
All of what I said?
No, just part, the last couple sentences.
In the beginning, you said it was...
In the beginning, this was a convenient, this was...
I don't think we need to compete with gas prices is really basically what I'm saying.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry. I'm having a hard time hearing you as well.
Well, we're not talking. So...
Oh, okay.
Well, the way I look at it is, you know... at a minimum, we should be break even.
Yeah.
And I kind of agree with the assessment of the 10%. Well, just to, at the 75 cents per kilowatt hour, I don't know what the actual cost would be to charge a car.
So the issue is actually, my colleagues and I have talked about this. This is why I called Northfield, because, and then I talked to Walter Ramsey and Montague, because right now it's a loss leader for both those towns. And we're trying to find the balance, but one thing that we need to do is at the next town meeting, we need to set up a revolving fund so that we can take money in and send money out. Because what's gonna happen, this is one of the reasons it's a loss leader, is you have a monthly electrical cost. And that's the thing that the other two towns are struggling with. And I think, Laura, you've talked to a couple of other towns besides Northfield and Montague, right?
I'm trying to remember. Well, I know in Greenfield at the town garage, I think it was $1.25 an hour, which at the time I thought was a lot, but I don't anymore. The demand charge is the big issue that muddies the waters. I don't know if you want to explain that, Casey, but.
Oh no, you get to explain the demand charge.
Well, the way I understand it is once, a line draws more than draws a high amount of kilowatts after the first certain amount. It's all in the email from Tim Simmons that you get charged that amount. You get charged an extra fee based on that, a multiplier based on. So since the charging stations, if the car is kind of drained, I guess, and it's going to pull the full amount of charge, which is the 7 kilowatts per hour, that adds a multiplier for the whole month, I believe.
Yes.
For the rate that we pay.
Once you spike there's for the month.
I'm sorry?
Once you spike that demand, it's good just for the whole month.
Right. So there's some legislation before that's being introduced to have the DPE look at that. Walter had sent something, Walter Ramsey had sent some information about that, but right now that's the status. So hopefully that will change, but right now that's what we're stuck with. So that's why, you know, I originally thought that we would just use the town's kilowatt hour rate, but because of the demand charge, you know, there's this extra.
Wasn't it also depending on what line the charger was put on? Like, I mean, maybe that's part of the issue, is that if you were on a line that was pulling, like had a lot of users on that same line, you weren't, you know, it was kind of leveled out a little bit more, spread out. And then if you were like one other small houses on this line and our charging station, now we're spending
a whole lot more money on that one line. I may have this all wrong, but that was what the lady in Greenfield kind of warned me about, was that it really had to do with the draw that we were putting on that one line.
It's by the meter, not by the... I apologize. I'm not positive about this, but I mean, we do have a dedicated meter just for the charging station, the way it's installed, you know?
Yeah. I thought it had to do with whatever, what else was on that line, but...
And can you limit the rate they charge
at? And, you know, there are other complexities. So here's the other place that I went to. Yeah, it's North Amherst at the Mill District. Their chargers, they have them set that they will only draw 3.5 kilowatts. Kilowatt hours, so they don't let you draw the full amount. So that's another approach, but that doesn't seem right to me, because I don't feel like anybody's going to be parking there for an extended amount of time. So we might as well let them draw the, you know, the amount and just set the rate accordingly.
Yeah, I mean, why would you limit them?
Yeah,
you want people to use it,
right? And, you know, this is all, you know, kind of still in the muddy waters as we're making this. Yeah, exactly. I mean, the image that comes to mind was when calculators, you know, first came out, and they were huge and expensive. And, you know, so we're still kind of in this stage of there not being that many of them, and the regulations haven't really caught up to, you know, make it realistic for the use of getting more people to use them. So I guess I'm you know, leaning towards what Tim Simmons suggested, and, you know, bumping it up to 75 cents a kilowatt hour.
Yeah, and then Montague was talking.
Yeah, so I think, Casey, if I'm remembering correctly, they went, the select board decided to keep it at 50 cents, even 30. Though it wasn't the break-even cost. Their charges
were They were at 30 cents.
They went to 30
cents. And assuming that, the town would be operating at a loss of about $2,500 a year. The option B was to increase the fee to 93 cents, which would be about a 210 increase, but would reflect actual costs to the town, electricity and billing fee.
Right.
And then the other was to make all stations free, which would be about a $3,000 hit to the town. So I'm not sure what they wound up doing in the end.
30 cents per hour.
They stayed with 30 cents per hour.
Yep,
so they're just taking a loss and seeing if they can get enough people to charge, which doesn't make sense to me. I think if we're going to do this, we're going to cover the cost.
We need to cover the cost of the town.
Yeah.
I feel like I want to support green energy and green things, but not at the expense of other things.
Well, and usually
it's a trade-off. I know it's not a lot of money out of a $16 million budget, but you have to realize that 70% of ours is school-related. So we're operating the entire town on 30% or not quite 30%. And honestly, you know, every penny, we look at every penny, and I totally agree with you,
Carolyn. I totally agree. And like I said, it's not going to be, we don't want it to be, back in the early days, here's a little bit of a story. We knew people who would just not charge their car at home. They would just go to a place that was free and charge their car there. I mean, we don't want to be suggesting that at all, that somebody just sit there and use the town's electricity. No, I think it should cover the costs. And like I said, it's not going to be cheaper than gas. We don't have to compete with that, but right now the gas cost is artificially low because of all the subsidies they get. And so until we make that huge transition as a society, it's a convenience. We're offering it as a convenience. And as far as the town is concerned, you know, we do want to promote electric cars because they're not polluting in the downtown. You know, there's all those added pieces, but it is a convenience. I think we're just offering it as a service, so the car owner can pay for it. Yeah.
So. So we're talking like 75 cents, is that what we're thinking?
Yeah, I think, so Laura, you're recommending about 75 cents, right?
Per kilowatt hour, yeah, to start out, and, you know, we'll see how that goes.
Right.
You know, for a couple months, and we, I don't know, Casey, we haven't talked with Greenfield Savings Bank in a while. I don't know if you have, but, you know, we have to just finalize all that with them. And then, you know, that $1,000 will be, will cover the network fee from ChargePoint and then be a little bit of a cushion beyond that. I think maybe $300 after they cover the ChargePoint costs. Can't remember the latest number I sent you. I think it was somewhere around $600 for the network fee.
Somewhere around that.
Yep. Okay.
Well, that sounds good, Lori.
Sounds good. It's doable.
Yep.
So,
what do you need from us?
Motion.
Motion to approve the 75 cents.
I make a motion that we do 75 cents.
And evaluate in a year.
Yeah. I'll or evaluate in 6 months or something like.
However.
That. I think it's worth looking at 6 months.
Okay.
You second that?
I did second that. Mm-hmm. Oh, I will now if I didn't already.
Oh, sorry.
Any further discussion? Okay. The only comment I have, Lori, is I would approach Eversource and see if they could put a non-demand meter on there, which is similar to a household meter. The demand meters are only on commercial.
Well, yeah, Casey and I did have a phone call with Tim Simmons, but I don't know if that's a request that should come from the town. Because it's a town meter, you're saying, as opposed to commercial.
Yeah.
So, okay.
I don't know if they would consider it. It's worth a question.
Yeah. We'll check it. Okay.
Okay. So for this, all those in favor.
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Carolyn Neff.
Aye, Dave Wolfman.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Lori.
Thank you, Lori, for hanging in there.
Okay. Take care. Thanks, you guys, for hanging in. Appreciate all you do.
Thank you. The library thing, do you want
to?
Or do you have something else?
Well, I didn't know if you wanted to do COVID-19, just start going down the list.
Oh, sure, yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
COVID-19 updates.
Well,
I wasn't sure why it was on, but.
I do want to mention as the Board of Health update. We had this our flu clinic on September 30th.
Yeah.
We did 214. We did, which is very similar to the year before. We did 220 the year before, but it was so much smoother going through the highway garage. It was the first time using color. It was the first in the county using color, actually. So we're pretty excited about that. We had two trainings before our clinic on the 30th, and so we have about 18 people that are trained. We probably need some more. We should probably have around 30. The highway garage where we were able to put work outside, we had a hot spot out there, so we were able to pick it up and people were able to check in, no problem. And some kind of grant will probably do an e-ink iPad because the the computer's laptops were heavy, you know, after a couple hours. And also, it was hard to read in the sunshine.
Yeah.
So this was all good information to take back and try to figure out what we're going to do for, like, a real clinic.
Right.
So that was very successful. And we used almost all our high doses. We only had two high doses left over. So I feel like our seniors really were good.
Lisa did another one. Here.
She did. She's been doing it here.
Oh yeah,
she's been doing it here. And
she did like 25 here, didn't she?
Yeah.
Yeah.
She did 25 here.
That's great.
And so I feel like we're getting coverage in her.
Yeah.
And we'll do the kids as soon as you know we find out about the kids' vaccine should be coming in pretty soon or should have come in, and as soon as we. You know, can get something through Bay State for the 5 to 12 year olds for COVID, then we'll do a flu clinic too.
Good.
So I just wanted to say that. And
I put on here masks and town protocols and policies because there was some concern. We were getting calls, like from Greenfield Savings Bank. They wanted to know if we were mandating masks. And honestly, last week we had no cases. This week we have four, but two were from a cluster from an Amherst daycare, and another was travel related. And the, you know, it's just two households, and so.
It's not community spread.
It's really not community transmission. The schools have had negative pool testing, and, you know, we're doing really well.
I agree with that. I think, you know, I've been asked that question, too. You know, we seem to be the one outlier town in all of Massachusetts or whatever, and locally, that hasn't had a mask mandate. And I've tried to explain this a little bit in social media, too, that, you know, we stand ready instantly. We'll have an emergency meeting if there is a outbreak that we can't control or don't understand, or, you know, and the question is, why don't we just have a mask mandate for protection? And, like, that's not really how you would, that's not how you do public health. If you're not going to constantly mask everybody up just in case, you do it as a resort to make sure that you're under control.
Well, people, if you haven't been vaccinated, you really should get vaccinated. There's no excuse. There's it really does work. People that are getting sick and unvaccinated are the ones that are in the hospital.
Yep.
If you're vaccinated, it's really a lot milder. There's just there's just proof of that.
Mm-hmm.
And vaccine is not a force field. We've gone over this and over this. It's a layer of protection. And you're training your body to respond, and you will be less sick.
Right.
But to keep from getting sick, you use the vaccine as your first line of protection. Then you use your mask if you're indoors with people that you are not comfortable with and there's not airflow and that kind of thing. And also then you have social distancing. You know, you just got to have some space between each other. And air circulation. So if people pay attention to that,
we keep the numbers low.
We are keeping the numbers low. What we want people to do is think about last year for Halloween. We had a successful Halloween last year because people were smart. They did things that promoted social distancing and protected the kids.
Yep.
So please, again, whatever you did for Halloween last year, try to do that again.
Absolutely.
It worked last year. Let's do it again.
Yep.
And you're thinking about family travel now for Thanksgiving and Christmas. Think about it really seriously. Is it really worth it?
Right.
You know, because our cases are related to travel, either family coming or going to visit family or going to on vacation. So when you are making your plans, really consider what you're doing for the holidays. We always have a surge after the holidays because people are doing things. So just try to be as smart as possible. Think about what worked last year and then what we're going to do now, you know, for this year.
I agree.
And we're watching this. We're constantly watching this. So, we will put a mask mandate in if it's necessary. But at the moment, the data is just not there. And we, you know, everything has been contained, and we know where it's coming from.
And we want people to trust us that when we do put one in, that there's a reason why we're asking. It's not just because we feel like it or people are asking us to.
It's not like a snow day where, you know, everybody cancels just because everybody's doing it.
Right.
We are really basing our decisions on data.
Yep.
And we want people to pay attention when we make that mandate.
Yeah, take it serious.
Take it serious, right.
Okay, thank you. Still getting some, you know, tick-borne illnesses as well. I don't want to keep bringing up bugs, but
we still do. Yes, well, to bring up bugs.
Sorry.
No, I just, one more mosquito thing.
Thank you.
We made it through the season.
He said tick, he didn't say mosquito.
I know. Well, I do want to say thank you to Kevin. I know he's on vacation, so he's not here, but I want to say to Kevin, we had lots and lots of rainfall this year. So we had, you know, the BTI dunks were washed out a lot. So he was actually doing extra, throwing the dunks into the catch basins and around different areas a lot more than he normally does. But it was hugely successful, even though we had a lot of rainfall. We had no West Nile disease in town.
And you're seeing it around, right?
It was around, but it was not here.
Alerts, but not here.
And Kevin did a really wonderful job, and I just want to say thank you. The state lab finished, you know, there are no more testing of, even though we haven't had a hard frost, they should actually go make adjustment for climate change because it's, we haven't had a hard frost yet. The mosquitoes are out there. So still be careful, but you know, we made it through the whole season without a disease load on being detected. And I just want to say thank you to Kevin for that.
It's a big,
but he did an extra, he has the dunks in his truck and he drives around and does it.
Yep.
And I mean, it really is a huge service to the town. And still be careful of ticks. The ticks are wicked. The next couple of weeks are going to be settling down for the winter, so they're going to be really, really active. And it's lovely now to go out for hikes in the fall.
Go out right now.
Yeah, and so please be careful. Please do tick checks.
Okay. Next,
wait. The Tilton Library, David. I put up the job description.
Yeah, this is what Candace, so this is on the agenda. Candace isn't able to come.
Oh, no.
So we could talk it over quickly. I was at the personnel board meeting when she was there. So.
Okay.
So the personnel board approved some changes in the job description, not the title, but some of the essential functions and some of the knowledge, skills, and abilities. And let me go back to my email. She actually sent me an email about it. Oh, wait, I can't.
No.
Email. Wi-Fi's not working. I already talked to Jennifer about it. So.
Get on anywhere.
So what was changed in this is the children's librarian position won't include working in teen collections or programs. And the intent is to develop a new position of a teen or young adult librarian further on down the line. Taking some of the hours from the current children's librarian position and from another part-time position to create more of a discipline focus. So what she changed in this was she took those references out and discussed it at length. And I had said to her, you know, when you're going to develop this, you're going to, and it's good that John Paresky's there because he correlates between the finance committee and what some of these initiatives are. So when they approved this, he's well aware of the fact that she's planning to make some changes budgetarily, but also to really refine the services that they're providing. So what was changed in here were some of those things. And further, the personnel board approved a higher rate of between 2508 to 2550 something.
And what is it right now, Casey?
Right now, the person currently filling that position is making over $28 an hour.
But that's because
so
they've been there for a long
total.
Right.
They've been there for a long time, right?
Right, right. Julie's been there for quite some time. 2530, that's it. So it's 2308 to 2530. And so this is, Julie, as you know, is retiring. She was here earlier. She is being, her rate right now is 2860. So this is hiring below that threshold, changing the duties somewhat, and really trying to capture some expertise that's focusing in the children's discipline, the children's sort of discipline, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
You know what, Stephen?
It falls within four and five, I think. I just don't have that in front of me. I can't get to it either.
That's with the new system?
No, that's in the current FY22. So we reiterated that with personnel board that right now we're working in FY22. Any changes that Candace wants to make for FY23 is part of what she has to develop for her budget. And we're also, we know that we're going to be beginning the work on the classification changes. So I had a conversation with Mary Accardi about that and with the personnel board separately But that's going to come up in the next couple months because we'll be working on budgets.
Okay.
And unfortunately, I can't get into my computer to tell you what that rate is. We looked at it, though, Trevor, we looked at it when we were at the personnel board meeting.
Okay. Okay.
So we looked at that rate and step.
Do you know why we're having problems with the internet?
We don't know, but we're working on it. We actually, so Friday, Thursday afternoon, Friday, and today went back and forth. We had some Wi-Fi connection earlier, and then it just crapped out. So Jennifer, I texted her
This was back on Friday because when we had the MVP program, you were having...
I was having trouble getting online so that I could...
I was gone today, and then it just shut off.
Yeah, it just, we don't know what it is. They tried to troubleshoot it this morning.
Comcast?
It's Comcast and Northeast IT because there's a connection point there.
Because I can connect, they just can't connect to the internet.
Right. So it may be that now we're in the Comcast.
My house on South Main with the Comcast, it just all of a sudden drops out on me.
Right.
Oh, see, Jennifer, maybe we should call Comcast too.
I think we should.
Sure, they tried to do some reboots and other things today. So, and then they told us to not log in as a guest, to log in through our main drive, and they gave us the password, and then that stopped working for Trevor and Casey. So I've already sent them an email responding to the earlier ticket. So I want somebody to come here, come to Deerfield.
Exactly.
I'm like, you need to come. So I asked them in the email, I said, you know, could somebody please come out because they
can't work.
This is ridiculous.
It's technology.
Actually been going on for a really long time because Alex, Search and Rendered, was trying to get onto his computer. This was a couple weeks ago and he couldn't. And so I just know that it's been going on intermittently for a really long time. And when they were doing the troubleshooting, they were saying that the Wi-Fi on Deerfield guest was at 60%. And he could actually see all of the devices that were logged in. And he followed me because I said, it's kind of like Big Brother watching me. Yeah, he could see where I was with my phone, if I was in my office or if I was out in the area that you're in. And
you figure they could get us some Wi-Fi.
So the thing is we got to regroup with it because it was working earlier. Now it's
like a doctor.
Well, it was giving you trouble in the middle of
it was
eating.
And it did it not only then, but later on Friday.
Yeah.
I couldn't even get into the S drive to get any of my documents.
Yeah.
Well, it's really annoying, I have to tell you, when you have to access information.
Yeah. Yeah.
She's trying to deal with the auditors and can't even get them.
I couldn't even get to the documentation to share with them.
Good.
So, they weren't happy. I got them most of it, though. Thanks to some help from my friend, everybody else in here. So, basically, that's what Candace wanted you guys to bless.
Okay.
You know, she got a blessing on the pay range. They approved the changes. Personnel Board approved the changes. Tilton Library trustees have approved it. So.
Okay.
So, I'll make a motion that we approve this job description change.
I'll second that motion, Trevor.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye, Carolyn.
Aye, Joe McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Walton.
Yeah. 9:20.
Mm-hmm.
Can we move this one along?
Well, I can move it along for you. Do you want me to go through the couple things that I just need you to hear? Okay. So the wastewater treatment plant operator vacancy change.
Mm-hmm.
So I talked to Kevin. This thing's been out for almost 18 weeks, and we haven't gotten any bites.
Ooh.
And we discussed not only with Keith, but amongst ourselves, making some changes in the vacancy notice to reduce some of the licensing requirements so that we can get somebody in.
Right.
Because we know we can get them through the certification process internally. It's happened before.
Yeah.
So it's not optimal, but right now we need to get up to speed because we know we aren't operating at a place we need to be operating.
Yeah.
Well, it's legitimately we can't expect people to work 7 or 6 or 7 days.
Exactly. So we're still troubleshooting that. So my suggestion, and Jennifer and Kevin came up with the changes.
Yep.
It basically, the intent is to decrease some of the licensing requirements in the vacancy notice so that we can attract
somebody.
Somebody
here and then train them.
Right.
Yeah. No,
right.
I'm all for it.
And Keith and Kevin and what's his name? Gary, all understand what that means.
Yeah,
so if you're okay with
the time frame to get the certifications.
Yes, and so the time frame on the vacancy notice is within a year.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Which is what we would expect for even a hoister's license or a CDL. So if you guys are okay with that, say bless you, Casey and Kevin and Jennifer.
Bless you,
go.
Casey, Kevin and Jennifer, go.
Cool, thanks. Mm. All right.
Next.
You dealt with the Oscar property. The capital expenditure request form. So at town meeting last week, town meeting approved, pending CIPC's approval, $150,000 for repairs to the church. So I did a capital expenditure request form because we are in 22 and we do have to present it to them. I wanted you guys to take a look at it and tell me, even if you tell me individually, if there's something you want me to add to it. That's a brief on what we intended to do, and we attached the estimate that we had. And I identified some of the things that were specific and other things that the town might be required to address outside of a generalized quote, which is what you had.
Mm-hmm. So there were, I thought I had heard some kind of ruffled feathers about us pushing this through town meeting without going to capital planning first, but I think the intention was that
we tried to.
From my, I know we all tried. It's running out of.
I'm on capital.
I know.
It's fine.
All I just wanted to say was that I think our belief is that we wanted to get something here in a bucket so that we could then get capital's blessing on it, get everybody in the room and kind of talk about really what are we tackling here? What are we doing? Let's get on a page. But if we had done all that, we'd have missed the meeting and have no money to discuss. So
right.
It's not like we're just trying to shove money down anyone's project. And
absolutely.
Just
absolutely.
Really want everybody's buy-in on this and work collaboratively.
Yeah.
So, okay.
If there's anything that stands out,
I mean, do we have, the one other thing I was thinking about is like finding out what the structural repair would be to the steeple. And, you know, are we going to tackle all of what's in here or are we going to, you know,
well,
I don't know what the plan is yet for the seniors or what about John's and all that stuff. So I'm kind of at a loss.
Has the bishop come back to us?
No. Reverend John, who's going to take it, as I had mentioned. I know I mentioned it individually, but I don't remember if I mentioned it at a meeting. I did have a conversation with Father John, and we connected last week via email. South Hadley has a similar setup where they actually have a rental agreement that they utilize the church, St. Teresa's down there, that Lisa Mead, our town attorney, set up and worked with Mike Sullivan, the previous town administrator, to get that rolling. And they've actually had to extend it because they had some slowdowns in their senior center project.
Mm-hmm.
So they're still working with this. And I said something to Father John. So he was going to take it to the bishop. I haven't seen a response to that.
Okay.
If the bishop's okay with it, then it's a question of putting it before you for me, depending on what it is. We have to go through the process of figuring out a time frame to be in there. And we don't know what that is. We can make a sort of guesstimate to go maybe through the winter.
Yeah.
But that's really what Father John and I need to sort of talk
okay.
through. And so my impression of the BOO meeting last week, and Trevor can weigh in on this, was they're interested in seeing us be able to utilize that space as effectively as we can. But they're also very interested in seeing some sort of solution to the senior center issue. So that's a competing infrastructure problem that we have. So that all needs to be in play. Everybody needs to remember that these are the other things that are hanging out there. And for us, I think once Father John and I can circle back around, we can figure out a sort of get an idea of a time frame, but leave us the allowance to continue to use the space if they will allow us to do that, if necessary.
Okay.
So that's where we are with that contract. And so I really just need to know if you think that captures what we're trying to do with capital.
I mean, it does, but I still feel like, is that the right choice? I mean, is that where we're looking to put the seniors? And so are we looking to spend the money there?
You have more than one volunteer. What we have to do is we have to follow through with the capital process. So even if we don't use them,
we still need to say, yeah, this is about, but
because
other than that, you know, the other thing is this probably falls short of getting the structure of the.
Yeah.
We don't even know. We don't even have an
estimate. Do, right.
The,
but it would lay out
there's
plan.
That's an engineering study that's going to have to be done.
Right.
This doesn't require an engineering study.
Okay.
The engineering study is something that I've been talking to the chief about. And because, well, in our packet here, we got the feasibility study.
That's
for
right.
UMass that we've possibly signed.
Yeah.
Right. And that'll get that ball rolling. Then look at what's going to be the best avenue for the town of Deerfield.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm guessing that no matter what we do over there in that building, we're probably looking at about 3 years.
The current building. The current building. Yeah, you're right.
And so that means this $150,000 is something. It's something we can invest into the church.
Mm-hmm.
We can use it for multiple things besides this senior.
We can. Yeah.
And you know, here again, it's just another one of my pipe dreams. But you know, I've been going through that structure and thinking that we can probably put in 8 senior house units within that building.
Which building?
Inside the church building.
Oh, yeah, could be.
Because, you know,
if you put a second floor in
the second floor with an elevator, you could put it in there and use that existing structure. Because the only weak part about that structure is the steeple right now. And from everybody I've talked to, they said it is a weak point, but we don't know if it was a weak point from 75 years ago or yesterday.
Right. We'll need somebody to look at that.
So, you know,
we need
a separate discipline. That's very specific.
That's why, you know, using that for, you know, with the organ and stuff is not a feasibility right now because we can't get an occupancy.
You can't occupy that space.
And how do we?
And I know Greg's upset about that.
Do we need another?
We have to be able to occupy the space to play the organ.
Do we need another meeting to appropriate money for that?
Well, of course, I got her and Jennifer wound up because I asked her the day after.
Witnessed me rolling my eyes.
Well, we do need to kind of figure out.
I think I had my hands around your throat.
I didn't want to say that, Dolph.
You know, a plan for abating at least that building
well,
to get it dry, and then
looking at that, there's
can't we go
estimate about $300,000 to do an engineering study on that building and exactly what to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
300?
300.
Somewhere in the neighborhood, yeah.
Huh?
Engineering.
Somewhere in that neighborhood.
For which?
But that would include the full engineering of it, so that
you mean
if we
plan decide, and
the plan and everything.
And
yeah.
Whatever. Oh, I see what you mean.
But
yeah.
One thing about the senior center piece is this feasibility study
that we're going to talk about up here.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's in the mail is addressing some of the requests for service. That's
right.
The intent.
Yeah.
And once you know what those requests for service are going to be, then you can go to that feasibility piece and say, hey.
Is this building right?
What do we need to serve the community?
But can't we go to the finance committee and get a reserve transfer for at least some information on the steeple?
Well, we got to figure out who to call. It's a very specific thing.
Yeah.
The only reason I know is I went through it for years.
Well,
sure,
Peter Thomas probably knows.
Well, no, you actually want an engineer to go in and
No, but
he knows of an engineer. Maybe.
He would know of an engineer because he was a FEMA.
I know of a couple engineers. That's not that's what I'm saying is it's a very specific discipline. There's an engineering company up in Vermont that does this, and they really focus on old buildings like that. But we need a funding source. And it's not a cheap thing. That's an engineering thing.
Find out how much and then get it.
But we don't know what we're doing with the building, and that's part of the issue.
I thought there was some agreement whether we ripped down the building or not, we were going to save the steeple with the town clock on it.
Right.
And put it on some other building.
That's true. So one way or the other, we got
to. So we should be saving the steeple. Now, this is why we're having this umbrella committee, is so that everybody can be in the same room and we can discuss this. But because here we go.
Right.
Another separate thing, another separate pot of money.
Yeah.
But I feel like, you know, we're this is getting to the critical point.
It is.
You know.
Well, it's like the.
Do you know how, you know, critical it is or not? I mean, I've been getting mixed messages, so.
Well, the first thing I got was the undercarriage of the whole building wasn't worth it.
Yeah,
was a that's problem.
Right.
Well, anybody knows anything about chestnut beams, those suckers aren't going anywhere.
Right.
I know, they're really rough.
There's some mealy bugs that are on the surface of them, but that's a characteristic. You go into my house, built in 1880, just down the street. You can see a few there. I've never seen a house as solid as that one. It's got the damn train running by it every 6 hours or more.
Well, I guess we can move on.
But, you know, it's right now for that building over there, because if we say we want to try to preserve that building, we can use $300,000 of CPA funds on that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. I know.
So it's.
All right. We'll talk to capital on this. We'll talk to finance, maybe somehow get some ballpark for the steeple thing and talk to finance about a transfer if they're interested to at least get the steeple squared.
When's our next select board meeting? Our next select board meeting.
Well, you have a executive session
The 20th. Could you post a CIPC meeting, like, say, at 5 o'clock?
Is spaghetti dinner not happening?
What?
No.
It's not?
The
triad?
Triad, no.
It's done? Okay. That was at 5. So.
I can reach out, but we had.
We have no chair, and we had.
Right.
Other
they have to reorganize first.
Right. So it's not going to get reorganized unless we post a meeting. So if we post a meeting at 5 o'clock on the 20th, then they could take this up.
Mm-hmm.
I know we could get Mark Brennan, maybe we could get Denise Mason and myself. So the three of us would be a quorum, and we could vote on this, and then we could reorganize.
Look for other help.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So if you did that. Can I say something
about the engineer?
Yep.
So Amherst went through this with the Jewish Community Center. And they had the steeple, they had a grant that they got from the Community Preservation Act Committee, got a grant to straighten the steeple. So I'm sure that they had an engineer for their steeple.
Yeah, we can find out who that was.
Yep, and they also had an organ, and they had tin ceilings and all sorts of beautiful things in that First Congregational Church there that now is the Jewish Center. But
okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Talk about transition.
Okay.
But let's post the meeting, Casey. Since we've had resignations, I will just request as a member that you post the meeting, and then we'll try to get this done, okay?
Do we have only one resignation from that at this time? Are we sure?
Two.
Oh, we have a confirmation of two?
I haven't seen it.
I have not seen a confirmation of two. I have a confirmation of one, but regardless of that, we have to find out who appoints that and then get those boards.
Well, the one I'm aware of is the finance committee.
Yeah, so they need to put somebody
forward. They need to put someone forward, and then Jack Davies emailed me and said he resigned.
Oh, I didn't see that.
I haven't received it.
And
I can forward you that email. He's
sent it to me. I don't know.
Well, can you forward it to Barbara? Because I don't know
one way or the other. And how did he get appointed? Was that a moderator?
He's at large. Yeah, and he's the chair.
CIPC appointments are outlined in the bylaw.
Right.
There's two moderator appointments.
So we need the moderator.
Appointments from the select board from other committees.
Gotcha.
Jack is a moderator.
Okay, so we need the moderator to put somebody else on, and then we need the moderator to put somebody on finance.
And he's aware of it. He's had two people.
Oh, perfect, great.
So he's aware.
That ball's moving.
All right.
Yeah, but that's why if we don't just pick a date and move forward, this is not gonna happen.
Right. Okay.
So, okay. The other thing, so that piece of it, if we want to move forward with this, then we can send it out and that'll be a prompt to request a meeting. The Deerfield Naturals Treatment Center compliance form from the CCC just needs to have an authorization vote and signature by the board.
Yep.
And it's in the signature file.
I read that.
Right. That red file has that.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
The Eversource streetlights purchase and sale agreement, I thought we were settled with it, but I talked to Esther Ballardini this afternoon. There was something she was going to look up. So I'm wondering if the board would consider approving the contract pending a significant change and signing at their convenience.
I thought we did that. No, didn't we do it last
time? No, you did the notice of intent to purchase.
Oh, thank you.
So what we were talking about was the actual cost of the lights, and we settled that last week.
Yeah.
And that number is in the contract, but she sent me an email later and said, there's one thing I want to check.
Okay.
I'll get back to you tomorrow. So she's going to call me tomorrow.
Okay.
But if you're not comfortable with it, then we just have to wait. And the problem with waiting is it really slows down our ability to take advantage of this Eversource program.
So you need a motion for approval of the purchase and sale agreement and a motion and in that motion to approve Casey to sign it.
I second that.
Great. All those in.
That was awesome. Yeah. How are you?
All those in favor?
Hi, Carol.
Oh,
hi, Trevor McDaniel.
We need to get this done. How many years? It's been at least 10 years.
Oh, I know. Yeah. And we're running out of time.
I don't want to miss anything.
We are running out of time.
I mean, I seriously remember this for at least 10 years.
Do you also need a motion on the Deerfield Naturals treatment compliance?
Yeah, you make a motion.
I make a motion
for David to sign it.
I make a motion to approve our chair, David Wolfram, to sign the CCC Deerfield Naturals Treatment Center compliance with the town's bylaw requirements and response.
Second.
All those in favor?
Hi, Carolyn.
Hi, Jordan McDaniel.
Hi, Dave Wolfram.
So you're going to post the meeting on this one?
Okay, so your next one is your collective bargaining activity representative. You need one for Frontier and you need one for Franklin.
I would be happy to do Frontiers. I had been trying all week to get a selectman from Waitley to do it, and it didn't work out. And then I had tried a selectwoman from Waitley, but I think she's already doing the elementary, and I don't think she could fit with the time schedules that they had. So I'm happy to do Frontiers, but... And Franklin Tech, I would just assume our representative Bob Decker would do it, but I don't know if he's already doing it.
No, he's the FRT.
He's Franklin Tech.
No, he is Tech.
Oh, he's
Tech.
We could ask him if he would sit on that board since he's already familiar with that board.
Yeah.
And he's done plenty of negotiations.
He has.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I just can't take on one more thing.
No, I know what you mean. Frontier is usually a little quicker than, and I think, and I wanted to also make a motion. I think we've done this already in the spring, but to have Skip Olmstead negotiate for the union.
Union 38.
So FRS?
No, just Union 38, just Deerfield Elementary.
Oh, okay.
So we need one representative for them.
Confused about.
And
is he willing to do that?
Yes, he is willing to do it.
Okay.
So he would do that. I don't know if any of the other towns want to put somebody up for Frontier either. I've talked with Conway. I've talked with Sunderland.
you know, Conway already has a member on there doing it.
It's just one of those things that's so painful.
Mm-hmm. So.
And you already know really what the outcome is going to be. It's even worse.
It's going to be a hard year. It's going to be a hard year for sure after COVID. And yeah, so I think, but it's important work.
It is. It is. It's, I mean, you don't want to give up on it, but.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
So is it, so let me just get this straight.
So we've got skip reunion, Deerfield. I'd like to ask Bob Decker if he would do Frontier.
So that was what I was going to say. So.
Yep. We can appoint him, and then if he just...
Well, that's what I was going to say.
No,
motion to authorize it if he wishes
to
serve.
Yeah, if he would accept. Yeah. So I'll make a motion to authorize Bob Decker to negotiate Franklin County Tech. Going to negotiate that.
Second. All those in favor?
Hi, Charlie McDaniel.
Hi, Dave Wolfram.
See what happens, Bob, when you're not in the meeting?
Hi, Carol.
All right, so then motion to authorize Skip Olmstead.
Yep, make a motion to authorize Skip Olmstead.
To represent?
Represent the Deerfield in the Union 38 negotiations.
I'll see that.
All those in favor?
Hi, Carolyn.
Hi, Trevor McDaniel.
Hi, David.
And again, I can do Frontier if the other towns are willing.
I have other meetings, but I babysat for a 19-month-old all day. And
did
the
you
dog.
Today?
Yeah.
You're awake. It's over.
He's tired. So did you want to do a motion to approve you representing in the FRS?
I would if the other towns are willing. If not, I don't mind stepping down for somebody else either, too. I mean,
No, I'm appointing you. I make a motion for Trevor.
All right.
You're not getting off.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, Chairman McDaniel. But I don't think
I know
where this is going to be. Quick and easy.
So who seconded that?
I did.
I didn't want to give him a chance to back up.
Oh, no, that's why we were like, we're doing it quick.
No, I think this will be fairly fast. I will check with the other towns if there's another person stepping up. Because, we were in talks with Joyce to do it as well, but it was a timing thing, and I don't know if it worked out. But I'm happy to step aside if somebody else wants to do this. But I think we need to have somebody there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. And then we had Deerfield Academy one day and liquor license still mm-hmm. needs to be done.
Oh, yeah. I'll make a motion to approve the Deerfield Academy one day liquor license for November 2nd.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Hi, Carolyn.
Hi, Charlie McDaniel.
Hi, Dave Wolfram.
It is.
Yep, I think it's.
Did you second that, Carolyn?
I
seconded. Oh, you made the motion.
Carolyn made the motion. Yeah.
Did I? I can't even remember. I thought I seconded it, but whatever.
In the town building at this hour.
I know. Before I forget, I won't be here November 3rd. Well, I might be, but I doubt it. I driving down back from New Hampshire. I have, my New England leadership meeting for conservation districts.
Yeah.
All the presidents get together.
That's November 3rd. That's Wednesday.
Yeah. It's, it's Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. It's a 3-day conference.
Okay.
So, it ends at like 5 or 6. So I'll be driving back.
Yeah, I'm not going to be here.
Yeah.
All right. Well,
I might get out a little early.
That meeting or just... See what we have for light business that time.
We actually have, I think that is, Jennifer confirmed this for me. We actually have the sewer rate set for that night, correct?
Mm.
Okay.
Yes.
So, and we do need to do that.
That's a 30, because it needs to be 30 days from the posting date. So.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
I guess you'll have to set the sewer rate without me.
I guess so.
So could I draw you guys' attention to an item in the mail list that I would like to give you an update on?
Sure.
Sure.
So you see the UMass Boston South County Assessment Proposal?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's for $25,000, yes. Mm-hmm. I talked to John and we got an update from Bob Dean. They have a little bit of extra money they could throw our way.
Oh, good.
So I would like to sign this contract and get it going.
Yes.
They can give us an, so they had committed to 10,000.
Yep.
They
found a little more.
Found a little bit more money, 5,000.
Great.
So
okay.
What we would do is we would have this contract with UMB, but also a separate contract with Dean.
Okay.
And the cost, so that we could
yep.
utilize, have access to the DLTA money.
Could I just, this is just a sidebar. Is it possible to have one or two questions in the survey related to senior housing? Because we were wondering if, you know, people hadn't, we haven't had an update for a long time. So if there was, you know, because you're asking the assessment of, you know, what people want. So we thought it would be wonderful if we could have one or two questions and we could work on the questions so they didn't have to generate the questions. We could generate the questions based on our past surveys
mm-hmm.
and what information we felt we needed to update for, you know, potential of getting a grant.
Valid part of this whole thing.
I don't know,
I don't
but
know.
We certainly could ask. And
yeah.
John,
well,
I'm sure, would be willing to ask that question.
Yeah.
Okay. The reason why is because, you know, we had the original survey from Lily's mom. You know, it was a fantastic survey. I mean, she was legitimately...
Mm-hmm.
You know, she did like Palm Beach and,
yeah.
you know, big Reno. She did really huge cities and stuff. So our survey, our original survey that we did was fabulous. And then we updated it again like 6 years later and she tweaked it a little bit and we ended up sending it out.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't, you know, do it again free. But
yeah.
So we had that one. But we hadn't had really any other update. We did a sort of little survey, and that was like 5 years ago.
Yeah.
So we've had three, we have consistent data, but if we thought we had one or two more questions that we could update, then it would give our original data an update, but it would also verify the trend of what people wanted in town.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be good if we were applying for a grant to have this information in our pocket. So we were wondering about that.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
So I'd make a motion to approve the professional service agreement between UMass Boston and Deerfield and authorize either the chair or Casey to sign. I don't know which one needs to happen.
$25,000.
Yep. So.
I second that.
All those in favor?
Hi, Caroline.
Hi, Trevor McDaniel.
Hi, Dave Wolfram.
Good to get that rolling. I thank Herzog for their help on that. That's great.
Casey, I'll talk to Lily and
yes,
her know
Lily
that we
send
need
me
a,
something.
Yeah, a couple of those questions.
The other thing that was in the mail was I just wanted to understand was the
Atlas.
The Atlas that was just notifying us that they cleaned up.
Yeah.
Cumberland Farm. So even though it just looks like a sand pit over there, it's
they actually did the 21E and did
yeah.
whatever cleaning they had to do.
Yep. So that's done. The other thing was the opioid settlement.
Yeah, I don't know anything about the opioid,
just
to be honest.
Yeah,
with
no,
you.
Let's just read this. We'll read it and come back to it. But there is a settlement, and I don't know if this town can participate in any of that or not. I don't know. The chief would know if it's, you know, could benefit the department at all or any of our
well we certainly incurred costs.
Yeah.
I mean we paid for Narcan.
Yeah.
On several
and a lot of training.
And a lot of our you know, and we had Narcan training. So I mean our EMS incurred costs, our police officers incurred
yeah.
costs because there was training and also Narcan use through the last few years. So I mean, there is some things that we can document.
Yeah,
so,
let's read it and see what
yeah.
we can participate if at all.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like paying for a funeral.
Yeah.
Make sure I have everything for you to sign. All right. You get to sign this. You all get to sign the
license, the liquor license, so I'll get your signatures while you're here.
That again.
Oh, my goodness.
At 10 to 10 when we're ready to.
All right, so you just approved that liquor license, the one day. Get it, are you able to?
Yeah, I just heard it.
What?
What's that? You have been able to.
That's what I used to do when I can't. Well, that's what I'm doing now.
It says no internet.
I email myself my notes. It's the intermittent problem.
And I guess it's intermittent because it's off again.
Yeah. I gave up earlier. I was lucky I got my notes to myself before the meeting.
I'll have
Chris,
them.
Are you having?
Thanks, Jen.
Well, now that it's coming up.
I just pulled up the packet before I leave my apartment.
Wow, that's terrible.
This is CIT sign. Anything else in here?
I think that the contract for the license, we'll finish that up. That's the other thing that's in here. We'll finish that up once I talk to Esther tomorrow. So you guys already. Once I get that settled, I'll sign it for you guys. And then.
You can sign this?
Yeah, you guys authorize me to sign it. And then what I do need you to sign, this is all the paperwork for the Eversource application. And I think you all need to sign this. And there's little signature things right here. This is good.
I filled them up with stickies.
Say that again?
I said I filled it up with little stickies.
Okay.
How did I already sign that?
I don't know.
Well, you thought that you had to sign it, and you remember you came in, and then I'm like, no, that's.
Oh, yeah. I did too. Yeah, I think I did prematurely, anyways.
Yep. Yeah, I was worried about. I was worried that we weren't.
Weren't going to be here. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Hmm. Okay.
All right. In terms of town administrator updates, yeah, we're having technical difficulties. We have them for several days.
Yeah.
We have a number of projects in front of us. So, and after all those meetings last week, they keep growing exponentially. I don't know how that happened. But we had a successful MVP meeting on Friday.
It was really successful. I felt we accomplished quite a bit. We picked dates.
Yes.
I think
there's a contract that I have to work on with Zach, is that his name?
Kevin?
The guy from the conservation place.
Kevin?
Oh, regenerative.
Trevor?
No, it was regenerative.
Were you calling Kevin or Trevor?
No, I thought his name was Kevin.
No, it was Eric.
Eric.
I don't remember his name. I remember his face.
I
wrote
Keith
it down.
Zoltenberg is
he's the
head.
Yeah.
And Eric is a new hire.
Right. Eric, that's his name.
Yeah.
I remember this name. I know. I'm so tired. I can't process.
He is okay. It's just I didn't take notes. Where's my notes?
I have the notes on my desk. If you want to, do you need them?
Well,
for right
I just
now?
Wanted. I think Trevor and David should know the two dates of our forum, climate forum.
Oh, I can send that to them. Tomorrow.
Okay. We picked two dates, an indoor date and an outdoor date. I think we picked.
Wasn't it February? Hold on.
Yeah, I don't know why.
Wasn't it the last weekend in February close to when we did it before?
We picked, February 12th, I thought.
Yeah, and then the 14th. Let me look at the calendar, and I can tell you.
Yeah, I have February 12th if it's an indoor, just like we did last time on the 29th of February. It was all day indoor at Frontier. And then the 14th of May if it was going to be outdoors at Frontier.
Yep. Correct.
Of May?
Yep. So, depending on the COVID situation.
Yep.
I'm going to ask Deerfield Academy to donate, you know, food again,
yeah.
Lunch. They did a wonderful
job. They did
lunch.
A great job. That was a good conference. Right?
It was. And
people enjoyed it.
They'll talk about several things you'd want to sort of follow up on, refresh your memory, but also in terms of access to some of these green initiatives.
Mm-hmm. We decided the focus last time, the focus was really, you know, we brought up to date on climate change, what was happening and all that kind of stuff. We decided to bring it in now. We'll talk about the regional impact, like 55% increase in frequent storm events and intensity of the events. So you have that kind of, instead of a global, it'll be regional. And then focus in on everybody, what are your car choices? What are your, you know, solar choices for your house? I mean, people are interested what we can do collectively and individually. So individually, what can we do to change? It's just like recycling. If everybody recycles, then the impact, you know, like what we're doing now, the amount that we're recycling is huge.
Yeah.
But in the beginning, it was just, you know, it was really a small amount. Mm-hmm. So it's the same thing. What can we do to change our habits and impact our own individuals? Because, you know, the whole solar thing is so confusing. You know, there's so many options out there, and you don't know who's ripping you off and what's a really good deal. And the same as the cars, you know, what's coming down the line for cars, and, you know, what should be. Yes, but at some point.
I'm ready. I'm so ready. As long as I can do 300 miles a day, I'm good.
Yeah, but at some point. Yeah,
you need a full electric. Tesla's the only one that does it.
Volvo's supposed to be coming out with one.
Volvo's coming out with one that they haven't quite hit yet.
Yeah.
But I mean, the F-150.
I know the F-150's out. I mean, there's things
the
F-150.
Yeah, the F-150s are supposed to be really good.
Yeah,
so,
but they can't make them.
Well, no chip.
They don't have the parts.
Oh. Anyway, whatever.
Ford actually shut down a number of factories.
Oh and man.
A motion to adjourn.
Well, anyway, yes.
No, I don't
talk about the climate change. No.
4 hours.
No, I know. This, like I said, I've been.
Second one.
I know. This is like
a long day.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank
you. We can talk about this another time.
Thank you, Dan.
Nice.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Dan.
Oh, my God.
Thank you.